It is a sunny, warm August Sunday in America's heartland. Temperatures in the 80s in downtown Indianapolis. Just 5 miles north and west, it's Speedway, Indiana. Population 12,000, yet home to the largest sporting venue in the world, the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, home of the Indy 500. Hi, everyone. I'm Mike Tirico. No, it's not the month of May, and yes, there are no fans here. But this is still a very special day on the American sports calendar because today a centuries-long tradition will be renewed. For the next few hours, the first driver across the yard of bricks will earn a right for his face on this place, the Borg Warner Trophy, as the winner of the Indy 500. Someone's about to make a memorable moment that will last a lifetime.
Say hello to this year's champion of the Indianapolis 500.
You always dream of winning a race like this and say something smart. But I'm afraid words escape me right now.
I didn't know it till I got the checkered flag.
I've been practicing drinking milk all week.
Thought for a second we were going to win that thing.
I'm so happy, I just can't believe it.
The proof's in the pudding.
It's just an incredible day.
This one's soaking in already.
No, he's squirreling! No, he's spinning!
If I got away with that and was still in the race, somebody was looking after me.
Who's going to win at the stripe?
I don't want to wait till next year. I wish it was today.
The closest finish in history.
Bunch of hungry, angry cars behind me. Little do they know I'm angrier.
Yeah! Derby
race
back!
Let's celebrate now! Yeah, baby! Woo!
We just won the 500.
We did it!
Gives you chills. Welcome to the 104th running of the Indianapolis 500. Our pre-race show presented by Rocket Mortgage. On inside this amazing place and the pagoda, one of the iconic spots of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. We're on the sixth floor, and welcome to your seat for the Indy 500. Mike Tirico, joined by Danica Patrick, who ran in this race eight times, six times in the top 10. First woman to lead the Indy 500, so you know about making history. And Dana, this is plain and simple an historic day. We've never seen a race day like this day at Indy.
Definitely not. I never have. This is the biggest single day sporting event in the world. So the fact that there's no one here is odd now that it's finally race day. I'm really feeling it. And we miss you. Like, I wish you guys were here because the energy that you bring makes this day so memorable. That being said, someone is still going to have a memory that not only is an amazing day, but changes their life forever in a few hours.
Yeah, we'll detail some of those great stories and amazing storylines we've been delivered for the 2020 Indy 500. And let's start with the Andretti family, synonymous with this race, this place, and this sport. That's why everyone has their eyes on that man, Marco Andretti, grandson of Mario, son of Michael. Last weekend in qualifying, he delivered a thrilling run to claim his first Indy 500 pole.
The final day of qualifying. It's the fast nine shootout to determine the pole position. Dixon to the top.
Currently quickest, average of 2:31.
Marco Andretti ran the fastest speed we've seen here in some 24 years. Could Marco create a special piece of Andretti Indy 500 history here today?
Green flag.
He is right there with Scott Dixon. It is level on time and speed. There has not been an Andretti on the pole position at Indy for 33 years. Can Marco
checker.
Do it?
Checkered flag, checkered flag.
Dorn, baby, you're on the pole!
That is so close. It's 2/100th of a mile an hour. You over Dixie.
The Andretti name lives on at the Brickyard.
So happy for you, buddy. You deserve this more than anybody I know. Enjoy it.
So many shared in that joy around the paddock, around the garage area, around the country. The Andretti family has been such a constant here, and Mario's win in 1961, that one that sticks out. Will there be another Andretti in victory lane in a few hours? Marco starts from the pole, and he's standing by now with our Marty Snyder.
Well, Mike, no doubt Marco Andretti has had the fastest car here for the entire month of August. But, Marco, you've talked about it. Having a fast car in qualifying trim and having a fast car in race trim, two completely different things. So what's the confidence level that you have a car that can win the race today?
I don't think speed is two different things. I think speed, you know, we're still going to need that today. But car balance definitely comes into play, especially with the track temps we're going to be seeing today and a little bit of wind. But, yeah, I mean, speed's always a good thing around the speedway.
You told me Friday that you were, quote, over trying to do it for the Andretti family. You wanted to do this for yourself and for Marco, right? So how much of today is about you? and trying to do something for you instead of the family?
Well, once we get my dad and my grandfather to pit and get off the track in front of me, then it'll be about me. So, no. I mean, it's all good things. It's been so good for our brand as a whole, and, you know, hopefully we can keep it going.
Your dad and your grandfather are going to be in front of you in the two-seater. Is that going to be a cool family moment, Marco?
It will be when I look back after, but I'll be so busy, you know, just getting the maps right, getting the tire temps where we need it, and stuff like that. But I think, yeah, it'll be a special moment. I know John's with us as well.
Yeah, no doubt about it. His godfather, John Andretti, who passed away earlier this year. You know, Mike, in the off days, Marco went back home, and grandfather Mario insisted, hey, come over for dinner. His advice that night, trust yourself on Sunday. You can do this.
Well, when you are an Andretti, it's a family affair, whether it's here in Indy or back in Nazareth, Pennsylvania. And speaking of Marco and Mario, you know, all the drivers, along with Marco, the other 32, joined in. They hopped in the Chevy Camaros and left the Speedway after the drivers' meeting yesterday and went down the street in Speedway just to say hi to folks who were outside and socially distant and masked up. And they went to personally visit some of the fans who really make this town and this place so special. How about that? You're hanging out on a summer Saturday, and here come some drivers, including Marco. And, oh, here's an elbow bump from the great Mario Andretti as well. The 1969 champ joins us here now. We celebrated you last year, 50 years, and it's an Andretti celebration again. What has this week been like for you, Mario?
Oh, phenomenal, I can tell you. I mean, so happy for him. Like he said this, but I agree. I've been on cloud 98 for the whole week. That's the beauty about being on pole at Indianapolis. You get to savor for an entire week. And now's the day. It's the day to just put the rest of it away, you know, the really important part of it. And again, we're all in and helping him. And he's going to have, you know, a lot of energy coming from us, hopefully. But he doesn't need it. You know, he knows what he's doing. I think he's proven that. So, again, Godspeed.
Mm. Mario, for the first time ever, you're all three going to be on track. And, of course, as Marco's laughing about and as we were laughing about the other night at dinner, you'll be first, Michael's second behind you. And like Marco was laughing, I'm still third. Tell me.
I like that,
with
actually.
With that take, I'm sure you do. How does that, just seriously, put this in perspective. How does that make you feel for all three of you to be out there so accomplished?
Danica, precious, precious moments. I mean, this is something that we will savor for the rest of our lives. Topic of conversation, and blessed. We're blessed to have this opportunity, no question. I mean, three generations. Who would have known, you know, like my first pole here was 54 years ago. And I would know that the 54 years from now, I'm going to have my grandson on pole enjoying the same thing. So again, I mean, it's this place has given us so much, and but we want some more, actually.
Gives me goosebumps.
Exactly, it does, you're right. and it's also given you some heartbreaking moments as a family, and you know as well as anyone, you can't get ahead of yourself at Indy. But you're not driving after you get out of the two-seater, so can you jump ahead for a minute? What would it mean today if Marco won the Indy 500?
Oh, my goodness. I'm going to do a snow angel right on the greasiest spot in the pits. And that's what I can offer firsthand.
That will be something to see. We love the Andretti family, and your presence here is a constant, and it energizes all of us. Enjoy the afternoon. Enjoy the experience, and best of luck to all of you today.
Well, thank you so much.
One of a kind. Mario Andretti joining us here. You know, they get that building sense of anticipation for all of us for the race. It is balanced by something we all feel, and Danica said it best before. It's a sense of loneliness. All of us miss the 250,000 fans, especially you Hoosiers who are home here in Indiana watching today. Y'all truly make this event the greatest spectacle in racing. But we're taking care of you. There's no better man of the people than our Rutledge Wood, who's keeping tabs on how the fans are spending a different kind of race day. Hey, Rut.
Mike, it's so great to be here with you guys. But, you know, tradition is really what makes this place so special. And on a year with so many things are different, why not start a new tradition? Take a look. This is the message in a milk bottle that the track decided to do. So they invited all 33 drivers down here. They signed the bottles, and then they answered two questions. Who are you racing for, and what would make a win at this year's Indy 500 special? Now, the winner will have this bottle brought to him. But we also thought, what if we invited fans to be a part of this message in a milk bottle? So you can use that hashtag, send it in, and take a look at some of the tweets that we got that really show exactly that. It's all about making people be a part of it. Strobe for Real talked about how his family packed in the car every year to make the trek to Speedway, Indiana. And for them, this tradition means more than any holiday. And take a look at this one. When you see families like Jana Quinn, who says, this is tradition. Indy 500 is family. It's what makes me proud to be a Hoosier. It's a special place to spend time with family on practice days and to see that race. It's a race of a lifetime. And guys, when we come back here next year, when I saw Roger Penske here for the Brickyard, he told me his idea is to have thousands of fans out here on risers to make this yard of bricks, like the yellow brick road on inside. He wants this to be a party everywhere you turn because the fans are the only reason that this place has worked and all these traditions have stayed a part of it. So Message in a Milk Bottle is a great way where fans can be a part of this today, Mike.
They're trying every possible way. Right? That's one of them. Here's another. It's a live look outside the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. If you drive from downtown, you come down 16th Street. Well, there's a spot over there where there's a gravel parking lot where you can see through a little opening in the grandstands to a big screen inside over in that turn one, turn two area. And folks are camping out. They're trying to keep their, quote, streak alive for watching the Indy 500 and being here in person. The drivers have a very personal salute this week to some of the most loyal fans of the Indy 500.
Just want to say hi to Barb Parker. I'm in your seat, D number one. It's a great spot. We miss you here this year. Thank you so much for all your passion for the Indianapolis Motor Speedway and being a longtime fan. We so much are missing you this year, and we hope to see you next year for the great Indy 500.
Hey, Callie McPike, it's Graham Rahal. I'm sitting in your seats in the East Stand, and while you're not here this year, we certainly miss you. I gotta say, you've got a great view here, and I hope in May of 2021 we'll see you back here at the races. Be well.
What amazing seats we have here in the South Vista. Cassie Johnson, I'm keeping your seat warm. I'm going to order some beers for next year, and we're going to have a great race. Make sure you cheer us on.
Be a lot of folks cheering Scott Dixon, who's a great chance to win this race here this year. The fans who were here last year, well, they enjoyed watching Simon Pagenaud cap a dominant month of May. We're going to hear from the reigning Indy champ coming up next. Pagenaud is one of eight drivers in the field who can tell you how much winning the 500 means. But that feeling of winning Indy sometimes doesn't require words.
I want to do that again so bad.
Just one of the greatest days of my life.
All is good in the world when you win this race.
I've always put a lot of pressure on myself to get to the top level. That was my goal. That was the top of the pyramid for me.
Simon Pagenaud wins in the most phenomenal style.
This will be the first time for the month, but do it again later.
This man has been in the mode this month of May. Does he go to the top? Yes, he does! Simon Pagenaud wins pole for the Indy 500!
This is incredible. This is the biggest race in the world. I'm on cloud nine.
This is the greatest spectacle in racing.
I never really thought about what it would be to be a winner of the Indianapolis 500. I thought about how to get there a lot.
Simon Pagenaud sweeps the month of May and wins. He's made an Indy 500.
The moment I won, it's a blur from then on because it just felt like my life just went 300 miles an hour.
Checker flag. Love you, superstar. Woo! Oh my God. Is this really happening? No. Into where Victory Circle is here. You've already been there. I told you to get there twice.
Getting to that goal is like climbing Mount Everest. I would say even now, I just feel relieved and like a new man.
Guys, we just won the Indy 500.
It carries on every day, every morning when you wake up, every night when you go to bed. All the efforts you put in are being rewarded, and that's what we're all after.
A magnificent May last year for Simon Pagenaud. A few months later, he got his baby Borg for winning the Indy 500. Next to him on the trophy, it was special for the Pagenauds, their beloved dog, Norman. Kevin Lee, maybe another special day in store for Simon and Norman today.
It certainly could be. And Mike, as you know, not many were able to come to the race this year. So Simon, the critical question is, did Norman make it on the list to come?
He's here, he's ready for victory lane, and he's a critical partner in this successful career.
You are already a series champion, but what did winning the Indy 500 do for you?
Well, it really is everything, and it's an understatement to just say that, quite frankly. It changed me as a man. Also, it allowed me to reflect on my career and be able to focus more on the moment now and enjoy even more what I'm doing and driving for the dream team, Team Penske. With Chevy on board, it's just an incredible time.
Now, you start way back in 25th. How do you get to the front?
I just thought I'm going to do it the opposite way this year.
Okay.
Starting at the back. But we've been working really hard. I mean, everybody at Team Penske since Monday, nonstop, days in and days out, been working on trying to find a little bit more speed, and we found some. So I'm very confident we have a really good race car. We were an 8 out of 10 after carb day. I think we're 9 this morning because my engineer, Ben Bretzman's really been tinkering on it, finding the last little details. And then in the race, we're going to have to take it to a 10. So my goal is to attack. We obviously have three different strategies. If my car can pass, we'll go to the front. If we can't, then we'll find a way with the pit sequence. So watch the Chevy Menard come to the front.
Well, he won from 23rd at Iowa last month. Mike, it is going to be fun to watch fast guys like Simon Pagenaud make their way through.
Yeah, Kev, thanks. A couple of interesting things there as he shows you the champion's ring there. Let's unpack those here, Danica. Let's start with just the sense you got from talking to Simon during the week.
Yeah, when he sat down with us on carb day, what came across is when he started talking about feeling really free after winning last year. And I was like, huh, I thought about that after. And I'm like, free, what does free mean? Does free mean I can be more aggressive and make hay faster? Or is free going to mean, you know, I've already done it and it might take the edge off? And that's something we'll have to see.
All right, we'll watch Pagenaud. As mentioned, starting way back in the pack, it's been since Johnny Rutherford in the mid-70s someone's won from that far back in the pack. And we talked about all the Team Penske cars. Qualifying wasn't great last weekend. Here's where those four are starting. Of course, this team owned by the legendary Roger Penske. We'll discuss him a bit later on. Simon just mentioned strategy there for the Penske cars. It's something you were talking about with me earlier this week.
Right. Well, Penske does an incredible job of covering their bases in a race. So depending on how each of their races are going, they'll probably get put into different strategies to allow for that best chance to win. Because if there's one thing that's for sure here at Indy, is that yes, the lead strategy is the best, but you can absolutely still win off strategy.
We will watch the four Penske cars. Simon Pagenaud was the winner last year, the runner-up in that legendary, amazing, memorable duel. Was Alexander Rossi, and there he is as he awaits with a fast car for this year. He sat down with Marty Snyder earlier this week to talk about the one he won as a rookie in 2016 and being so close last year.
Is it going to be Rossi? Is it going to be Pagenaud?
I think it's going to come down to the checkered flag. Simon Pagenaud wins.
Sorry, I couldn't do anything.
This one will be hard to get over. Nothing else matters here except winning.
Leaving this race, is that the most disappointed, gutted you've ever been leaving a racetrack?
I'd rather finish fifth any day here than second, because, you know, I think about last year more than I think about 2016. Like, what could I have done differently? You know, you watch the last stint back and it's like, was that, you know, too conservative? Was that too aggressive? Could I have seen that coming? And obviously in hindsight, yeah, there are a lot of things that I look at and could have done differently and maybe would have had a different result. In the moment, I did the things that I thought were the best. But yeah, I mean, that sticks with you even more than the one I won, because it feels like one that kind of got away.
Maybe it's this place that brings out that passion in you a little bit more. Is that fair to say? There's another level here?
100%. This place doesn't owe you anything. You can have 5 years of success here and then come back for year number six and be struggling. So it's you have to appreciate the days when you have a car that's capable of winning.
Alexander Rossi for the final time. Twin checkers are out and the rookie will win the 100th Indianapolis 500.
You just won the Indy 500, baby!
Oh my God. I had no idea I'd be in IndyCar. I had no idea I'd be in the Indy 500. I'm at a loss for words. It will change my life for sure.
2016, you win here. And why did you not know how to react?
Like, it was my fourth IndyCar race. So I hadn't even really been successful in a normal IndyCar race before.
Right.
So the first one that you're ever like in the limelight was the 100th running in the Indy 500. I didn't think I was going to win the race in the first. I didn't think I was going to finish the race in the first place. It was a very strange situation. And I pray that I get the opportunity to kind of do it again, right? Because it'll have such a different feeling for me.
What would 2020 Alec say to 2016 Alec?
I think that the biggest thing would be, you know, you need to try and win this race at all costs. Mm-hmm. Type. And it's weird because that's what we did in 2016, but now it's like I've said, you don't know when you're ever gonna get the opportunity to be up front again. And when you do, and when you have it, and when you're 10 laps to go, like it's something that, like no other race, you have to win it at whatever the risk.
I love his honesty. There's real disappointment from last year. Danica, can he take any of that bitterness in the car a year and 13 weeks later and have it be a positive for him?
100%. You don't forget. What I can hear from him is a tremendous amount of adoration for the Speedway, but respect.
Right.
And respect that your car isn't always good, and that's so true. I was talking to Rinus McKay, and I told him, like, you're not always going to have a great car here, so take advantage of it. And what I can see is Rossi's, like, bitterness towards last year of how fast he was and how well he did, and not wasting it, but missing the win because of, you know, other circumstances. So I feel like, to be honest, I think he's more hungry this year than the year he even won, because he knows he has a good car.
He's been great around here. Top seven, all four Indy 500s. He starts on the outside of row three in about an hour or so, and perhaps a chance to enjoy again one of the three iconic Indy 500 symbols of victory. You've already seen the BorgWarner Trophy, which has honored the winners since 1936. That year, Louis Meyer celebrated with a glass of milk in Victory Lane, and another tradition is born. And then there's the winner's wreath. Rutledge has more on the tradition celebrating its 60th year today.
I'm here in Yorktown, about an hour away from the track, to find this tradition that made its way here to Buck Creek and Bloom in 1992. Julie Vance is the wreath lady. She's been making the Indy 500 champion wreath for 28 years. Let's go see how it all comes together. Do you trust me enough to try this? How about right there? I'm in the foam, but no one will see it. This is Julie Vance. This is so beautiful.
That's our piece of the 500 here at Yorktown.
Remind me, how many orchids are there?
There's 33.
Start to finish, how much time does it take you to make one of the wreaths?
At least 6 hours.
That's amazing. What's your favorite thing about being a part of the Indy 500?
Just the tradition of it all. I think that's wonderful, and the fact that it's probably the most photographed flower arrangement in the world, possibly.
I bet. Whoever wins the race, if one of these flags pokes you in the neck, that's my fault. I apologize. It's my first time.
You're watching Indy 500 pre-race coverage on NBC. Brought to you by Rocket Mortgage. Home loans that fit your life. Rocket can. And by Speedway, the official fuel and convenience store of the Indy 500.
Back here at Indianapolis, James Hinchcliffe has worked with our NBC team during the year covering some of the first six IndyCar races. He's traded the microphone for the wheel today and has a pretty good car as well. Hinch going to start sixth outside of row two. We'll be keeping an eye on the mare as we go through this afternoon with the Indy 500, about an hour away, a little overcast, and a little bit breezier than we had planned. Hey, we are missing our third.
Definitely breezy.
I know, can't you tell by my hair, right? But we're missing our third Musketeer. We got to hang and watch the race last year with Dale Earnhardt Jr. He, of course, is with our NASCAR team. There's a doubleheader at Dover. The second part of that doubleheader comes up later this afternoon on NBCSN, but Jr. joins us here for a minute. We all had so much fun watching the race together, Dale. I'm curious, after being here in person last year, what from that experience are you looking most forward to as you check out our race here this afternoon for a bit?
Well, it was just a great race. You know, we saw such an exciting race last year, some great strategy. And so I'm looking forward to, you know, seeing who tries to create something unique out of the strategy this year. But I still feel like, it's such a different and unique event because of the date change, because of the lack of fans being there. When I went there last year, my experience was so unique, genuine, and traditional. And so it's got to be extremely, I don't know, challenging, I guess, for the drivers to walk out on that grid and get in the car, really kind of buckle down and go win this race when it looks like no Indy 500 that they've ever experienced before. So, You know, I think that's going to be the biggest challenge for the drivers is who can sort of psych themselves up, because this is an important race. This is still the Indy 500. There's still a, you know, an amazing trophy to win and a lot of experiences that come from winning this race. Mm-hmm. Who can go out there and really kind of build that up in their mind, because those fans are the major motivator and they're not there today.
Dale, with you having a very famous last name and Marco having a very famous last name, of course, I have to ask you about that dynamic. And now you're not Marco, so I don't want you to tell me what you think Marco's going through, but what would you be going through and what would you be thinking if you were in his position today?
Do I got a good race car? You know, you qualified extremely well, but then you go into race trim and it's a whole different animal, whole different setup. Do I have a car that can win this race? I think that's probably the next, you know, thing that pops into your mind. And we know that's been a challenge for him to find that speed or that comfort in race trim. And so I'm hoping for a great, successful race. I went to the race last year, got to meet Marco and talk to him. We had been friends for years, but never really met. So that was, you know, the power of social media has kind of made us become friends before we actually saw each other face to face. But it was such a struggle last year for him in the race. I'm hoping he has a better experience today, starting on the poles. That's a great thing, but I know that he really wants a great result in the race.
I know who your favorite driver was last year, Santino Ferrucci, the rookie from Connecticut. He's on the inside of row 7. I'm keeping an eye on him for you, but give us a pick. Who do you think is going to win it all today?
Well, I talked about, you know, those fans and them being the motivator and how that could affect drivers. You know, all the drivers have talked about it all year long, whether it's NASCAR, no matter what discipline it is. It's just been challenging racing without fans during this COVID. And so I think the one guy that may be least affected by that is Rossi. And he's just confident, as Danica was saying, in his car. I think that he learned more last year in losing that race than he's learned in any Indy 500 that he's ran. I think he comes in knowing what he needs to do, knowing how to win this race, knowing what, you know, what can happen and how things can fall and maybe what he might change or do differently from last year to stop from losing that race. So my money's on him. Like you said, he's got a great track record here. He runs well here. Some people just sort of match up well with certain circuits, right? Okay. Dale Earnhardt to Daytona, maybe Rossi is that to Indy.
All right, we got you down for Rossi. We'll be watching that, and we'll be watching you guys after our checker flies here for the NASCAR race, NBCSN, the second end of the doubleheader at Dover. Thanks, Dale Jr. We'll see you back here next year, all right, man?
All right, I hope so. We'll see you guys soon.
You got it, pal. IndyCar, like NASCAR, have put COVID-19 testing protocols in place to begin and continue the season and have a day like today, the Indy 500. Around motor racing and the country, we can't stop often enough to express our gratitude to all those working on the front lines of the COVID-19 pandemic. And here's an example among them. Two doctors who were working at the Mayo Clinic during the height of the pandemic, their use of the power of music to spread a message of hope with a performance of John Lennon's Imagine went viral. This duo joined us here in May for our Back Home Again special, reliving last year's Indy 500, and they are here today. The doctors, Elvis Francois and William Robinson, they're going to perform our national anthem in the pre-race ceremonies, which culminate with the engines getting started. And speaking of that famous command, throughout the past few weeks, NBC and Advance Auto Parts have been asking you, the fans, to send us your best start your engines command. So now let's take a look at some of the best submissions you've sent us.
Drivers!
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 Start
your
engine!
Engine!
The Kentucky Derby was amazing. To me, it was like being able to experience the Indy 500 again from the outside.
And they're into the stretch.
The energy level felt the same, just in a shorter dose.
Yeah!
I've never been so excited in my life.
The Derby in 2 weeks, Stanley Cup playoffs, NASCAR playoffs, Tour de France, French Open, the NFL season starting. What a couple of months ahead on NBC Sports. And don't forget the PGA Tour playoffs, Tour Championship in 2 weeks, the BMW Championship next weekend on Golf Channel and NBC. As you look at Brickyard Crossing, four holes of the golf course inside the 2.5 mile oval here at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. The perfect setting for our team's season-long social media theme. Lee Diffie going business on the top and golf on the bottom this week. Quite a look. been here for a couple of weeks, so a chance for the guys to hit the links. But we are thinking a different green now, green flag, as we get closer to the race, and we will join the guys calling the race, Lee Diffie, Townsend Bell, and Paul Tracy. Nice look, Diff.
Mike, please do me a favor. Never show that again.
I will, promise.
It was a fun day on the Brickyard Crossing golf course for sure. But now it's time to transition to business. And Townsend, you know, you can go back to your first Indy 500. You did 10 of them. The famed Gasoline Alley. It's time when your team says, all right, let's go. What's that walk like? Because the drivers are about to do that.
Well, under normal times, that walk is the realization of the magnitude of the moment when you see 300,000 people in the stands, and it really hits you hard because the drivers normally are here since, you know, 5 a.m. or have spent the night here. For Joseph Newgarden, as he walks out now, I think it'll be the shock and the reality of how unique this COVID-19 Indy 500 will be. For rookie drivers, though, This is their first time, so it's really no different than it's been for practice and qualifying. So I think in this moment, the shock will be for the veteran drivers. But candidly, Lee, every year, I did it 10 times. Every year I would walk out and feel the weight of the moment there. I really was always just focused on the mission. This is, you're going into battle here, and you really have to think through the details ahead of you, despite the biggest crowd in all of sports.
If you were with us for qualifying weekend last weekend, you will know what I'm about to talk about. If you weren't, a real treat for today's 104th running of the Indianapolis 500. 2003 IndyCar champ, PT, our very own Paul Tracy, in a really unique location. And Paul, it has been thrilling to hear the excitement in your voice to get a very different perspective. You're there in turn two. We'll talk about that in a moment, but do what Townsend just did for us, if you wouldn't. Tell us what your walk down Gasoline Alley was like when it was time to go.
Well, very similar to what Townsend just said. When you walk out and you come out to the crowd of 300,000 people, it's like sensory overload, and we just don't have that today because of COVID-19. There's no fans here, but the range of emotions that the driver is going through and thinking about on the walk out is a lot of nervous anticipation. Am I going to get a good start? Is my car going to start? Am I going to get the pace laps right? Am I going to get through the first corner? So you're thinking, you know, just that nervous energy of, that's the most hectic time for a driver. It's just getting through the start of the race and getting the race going and then having a shot to win later.
And you see the Ganassi trio there of Scott Dixon, Marcus Ericsson, Felix Rosenquist walking out. Here is the pole position winner, Marco Andretti, wife Marta, father Michael, there on the left. You know, most of us didn't grow up with famous parents or grandparents or a famous last name that commands significant expectations. Well, that guy right in the middle certainly did. I sat down with Marco Andretti a few days ago to delve further into what it's like to be an Andretti.
It feels bigger than a race win. Unfortunately, I haven't felt what that feels like in too long, but I think what this place means, in combination with our family and the whole the curse thing and everything, I think it casts a wide web. Coming off of last year, which was just, you know, it's all about Mario and the livery. And when I look at it, it wasn't about me. And I think if I'm going to extract the most from this sport and myself, it has to be about me.
Is this almost the turning point of you're your own man now?
I'd want to hope so, because I know outside of the sport, I'm 100% my own man. And I think that's why a lot of people, when you get me away, they're like, wait, he's actually a nice guy. And that's a front that I don't want to put up, but I don't know I'm doing it, you know, because I'm so intense and I want good results. But that's one of the things that I wish I could change about myself.
You're not doing this for Mario. You're not doing it for your dad, Michael. You're doing it for you. But this year, there is a special angle. You're doing it for your godfather, right, John, who sadly passed away this year. How much is that a driving force?
We knew what this place meant to him, you know, and our family. And she said, he's been riding with you 100%. And we feel that. I mean, even on the last lap of the qualifying, I mean, that could have went either way when you lose or win by 66 inches over 10 miles. You know, he's a very close second to my grandfather, Mario, as far as passion just for the sport. And you know, guys like him and guys like Brian Herta and guys that have just been there and know what I could do. It's just that's what, you know, feels so nice to me.
Finally, being an Andretti is?
Is the biggest blessing in the world. I mean, you know, yes, there is the double-edged aspect of it, but it's not hard to be Marco Andretti. I'm a very blessed person. Result-wise, yes, I wish I could have won more races, but you take me away from the sport, I mean, it's you know, it's unbelievable. My wife, my family, my dogs, I'm a lucky person.
qualifying for the Indianapolis 500 is often considered the second biggest race of the year, even though it isn't a race. And Marco, as he's there messing around with Tony Canani's good friend and old teammate, he feels like he's won the second biggest race of the year. Paul, what's your take on Marco's situation right now?
Well, he's got impossible shoes to fill with Mario and his dad. They won so much throughout their career that it's an impossible goal to find. But I've gotten to know Marco a lot better over the last couple years, and I can tell you, he's been concerned about what people think on the outside. If he goes on vacation with some of his famous friends, he's not committed. But I tell you right now, he's kind of been stalled, but now he's found another gear, and I think he's going to take his career to the next level today.
I agree, Paul. You know, last Sunday, Marco's four laps in qualifying were absolute magic. He did it on his own. Grandpa and Dad weren't there to help him. He had to do it himself. And in just a little over an hour here, Marco's going to do it on his own again. He's got the fastest car in the field. We'll see if he can hang on for 200 laps.
Danica, you've known Marco for so long. You had dinner with him earlier this week. This is the biggest moment of his career.
Absolutely. To mirror what you guys have just been saying, there's a change in Marco. And what I've seen from him is very much not, I wouldn't call it relaxed, but he's like a present Marco. He's not distracted. He's not looking at his phone. He's not, he's just with it. And I think that that's a maturity that comes, like he said, wanting to do things for himself. It's like when you get older and you're kind of like, you don't really care what people think anymore. So you start doing things for yourself.
We'll see if Marco Andretti is able to take that newfound attitude and confidence to victory lane. Other drivers to talk about, introductions, back home again in Indiana, great flyover, whole bunch more coming between now and the green.
You're watching Indy 500 pre-race coverage on NBC. Brought to you by Rocket Mortgage. Home loans that fit your life. Rocket Cab.
That cloud cover will help keep track temperatures down. That'll be important. Townsend, Paul, and Lee will be talking about that once the green flag drops as we get closer to that. This race watched all over the world and seen winners from a dozen different countries. Obviously the most from America, but you see all the countries represented, including Takuma Sato from Japan, who's on that first row here today. Now, over the last 31 years, things have changed a little bit. The international flavor's taken over. 22 wins by international drivers last 31 races, including five different winners from different countries. Alexander Rossi, the U.S., but Colombia, Japan, among the nations represented. And in the field this year, just a few more international drivers than Americans as we get set for this race, including that international, two Spaniards, and Fernando Alonso, the two-time Formula One champ who was bumped out of the field last year but is back in and makes his second Indy 500 start here in August in this very different Indy, but it still carries that global influence that it usually does. Now time to meet the drivers. We begin with a special message from 2014 Indy 500 champion, Ryan Hunter-Reay.
It's an honor to represent this year's field of Indy 500 drivers. We hope you're at home safe with your families. I know you'd like to be with us, but trust me, you are. This one's for you. So strap into your seats, get ready for one heck of a show, and we fully expect next year's race to be a packed house.
Thank you, Ryan. Let's meet the rest of the drivers for the 104th running of the Indianapolis 500. Driving the number 81 Dragon Speed USA car from Manchester, England, Ben Hanley. Making his 10th Indianapolis 500 start from Sausalito, California, J.R. Hildebrand. Former Indy Lights champion making his 7th Indy 500 start, Sage Karam. Outside row 10 for Carlin Racing. From England, it's Max Chilton. Starting in his 10th Indianapolis 500, driving the number 4 Traceva car, Charlie Kimball. It's Spider-Man, 3-time Indianapolis 500 champion from Sao Paulo, Brazil, Hélio Castroneves. On the outside of row 9, hailing from Melbourne, Australia, James Davison. He's the two-time Formula One champion, driving the number 66 from Spain, Fernando Alonso. And he's a defending Indianapolis 500 champion, looking to make it two in a row, driving the Menards Team Penske number 22, Simon Pagenaud. Outside row 8, driving the number 41, a rookie from Canada, Dalton Kellett. In the middle, 2013 Indianapolis 500 champ, TK Tony Kanaan. And here's your 2018 Indianapolis 500 champion, driving the number 12 car for Team Penske, Will Power. Outside of row 7, a rookie driving for Arrow McLaren SP. He's the 2019 Indy Lights champion, Oliver Askew. Starting in his fourth Indy 500 from Basingham, England, Jack Harvey. Inside row 7, a 22-year-old from Woodbury, Connecticut, in his second Indianapolis 500, Santino Ferrucci. It's coming down on me. Noblesville, Indiana, making his seventh Indy 500 start, Connor Daly. Driving the Gainbridge number 26 for Andretti Autosport, Zach Veach. And piloting the number 20 United States Space Force rocket, he's a three-time Indy 500 pole sitter, Ed Carpenter. Monterrey, Mexico, driving the number 5 Arrow McLaren SP car, Pato O'Ward. In his second Indy 500, driving the number 10 car for Chip Ganassi Racing, Felix Rosenquist. Inside row 5, a two-time IndyCar champion, Joseph Newgarden. Outside in row 4, another former Indy Lights champion in his fifth Indianapolis 500, Spencer Piggott. In the middle, making his second Indy 500 start from Sweden, Marcus Ericsson. And driving the number 88 Cleaners Food Bank of Indiana car, Colton Herta. Outside of row 3, the winner of the 100th running of the Indianapolis 500, Alexander Rossi. In the middle from New Albany, Ohio, a six-time IndyCar race winner, Graham Rahal. Competing in his first NTT IndyCar Series season with Dale Coyne Racing, a rookie out of Barcelona, Spain, Alex Palou. Sixth position, the 2011 IndyCar Rookie of the Year from Toronto, Canada, the mayor of Hinchtown, James Hinchcliffe. In the middle of row 2, 2014 Indy 500 champion, Ryan Hunter Ray. Another rookie driving the Sonex number 21 from the Netherlands, Rinus VK. Now, the front row for today's race. He's the 2017 Indianapolis 500 winner from Tokyo, Japan, Takuma Sato. Five-time IndyCar Series champion and 2008 Indy 500 winner, from Auckland, New Zealand, the Iceman, Scott Dixon. It's been 33 years since an Andretti was last on the pole for the Indianapolis 500. He will lead the field just like his grandfather Mario. In pole position for the 2004th running of the Indy 500, Marco Andretti. And there is the starting field for the 2020 Indianapolis 500.
The voice of Bob Jenkins introducing the 33 drivers, which one will be on that new victory platform in a few hours. We'll hear from some past Indy 500 champs as we continue to count down to the Indianapolis 500.
Did you ever think it would lead to this?
Well, I sure didn't, but I'm sure glad it did.
I kind of grew into this place. We followed Indy, obviously, but never dreamed of coming here.
Here comes the checkered flag awaiting young Rick Mears at age 27.
79, winning that was only in our second attempt, and I didn't understand what it meant to win Indy.
Rick Mears, he's won the Indianapolis 500 with a hand in the air. Rick Mears has won his third Indianapolis 500.
It is the Super Bowl for us.
Rick Mears heads for number four.
You know, the fourth victory is the most gratifying.
Rick Mears becomes the third four-time winner of the Indianapolis 500.
Indy's most exclusive club, the four-time champs, joined it in 91, and he joined A.J. Foyt, Al Unser Sr. Rick is here today. He's trying to help usher in a fourth member to the four-win club, because Rick Mears is spotting for Elio Castroneves, who today, it's try number 10 for win number four. Remember 2001, Elio climbed the fence. He was the last one to win the Indy 500 back-to-back. It was so nice, he did it twice and climbed the fence again. And then another victory in 2009, his third. Some near misses since, and Kelly Stavis, it's only made him hungrier to try to get number four here today.
I'm sure it is, Mike, and it's hard to believe it's been over a decade since Spider-Man last climbed the fence here at IMS Speedway. Elio, it's your 20th start, but could be your final with Team Penske as you try to join that elite club of four-time winners. What are you thinking mentally and emotionally heading into this race?
Okay, let me tell you, at this point, this is an incredible moment. I feel extremely honored and proud again to be driving for an incredible team for so many years, representing incredible brands like Pennzoil in this case. And no question right now, I miss this kind of excitement, this rush. You know, it's like I was getting myself ready. I'm like, this is absolutely what I love it. So looking forward to a phenomenal race. We're going to have to work a little bit, but hey, nothing came easy in my life, so it's not going to be this time. So we're going to work hard for it.
You are a fan favorite, of course. No fans here in the stands today. Have you thought about how you might celebrate this one, should you win it?
Certainly, it's not the same without the fans. However, I have to say I'm glad that Roger decided to go with the race, because now the fans had an opportunity out over there, you know, on TV, watch us. And hopefully when everything's come back to normal, we can go back and have the fans again. So I'm extremely excited for today.
Elio said he's going to have some work to do. Kevin, that's because he starts this one 28th.
Kelly, Ryan Hunter-Reay's face is also on the BorgWarner from winning the 500 in 2014 in that incredible duel with Elio Castroneves. So what did that and 11 other 500s do for you that you can take to today?
Yeah, certainly experience counts in this race. But, you know, in the past, when we won the race, we started 19th. And at the beginning of the race, I was just trying to find my feet, figure out where the car was, and really came to life about halfway through. From there on, I knew I had a car to win. But we've also started at the front and felt the same way. So really today, it's hotter than we've seen. We're just going to have to keep working on this 28 DHL Honda, making it better and better through the race, kind of comparing ourselves to others and going from there.
You've got a strategist that plans pit stops and fuel saving and so forth. But what does the driver do to plan for the end of the race when it's back and forth?
I think from half point on, you're sizing everybody up. You're saying this car has this weakness here, I think I have a better run there. And you're compiling all that information as you get into the end of the race to apply it. And then from there, the gloves are off. And hopefully we have this DHL car up front at that point, because I'm really looking forward to a fight. Hopefully we can be in it.
Marty, Ryan Hunter-Reay is trying to become a two-time winner from the second row.
Well, Kevin, if you believe everybody in the paddock, they'll tell you Scott Dixon likely the guy to beat today. And you said you've come into the race with this kind of confidence a few times. Is this the most confident maybe you've ever come into a 500 that you might have the car to beat, Scott?
I think you're always confident. You have to come into this race feeling that way. Unfortunately, you know, this circuit can definitely rewrite history in its own way. And sometimes, you know, you need a whole lot of luck. So I hope there's a lot of people sending us a lot of luck today. We're definitely going to take anything we can get. But the PNC Bank number 9 has been super good all 2 weeks. And obviously a big thanks to HPD and Honda. You know, proud to be powered by them. They've done a tremendous job, especially in qualifying. We'll see how the race fans pans out today. It seems like the group's a lot closer once you get into race running.
As your attention turns to the race, as you get ready to climb in the car, Scott, much hotter today. What kind of factor will that be? And then, two, when you have a car this good, the tendency is you want to lead. Is it better maybe to ride second and third and save fuel today?
I think we definitely see this year, because of the aero screen, that there's more of a penalty to maybe lead, you know, just fuel mileage. And it doesn't take long to get out of whack, right? You know, it can only take two or three stints, you know, three laps a stint, you know, then you're 9 laps out of whack with the field. So we'll see. We'll monitor it. You know, obviously, we hope that the car's really good and we hope that we're in a great position. But, you know, this place, again, between lap 160 and 180, always seems to throw a caution that kind of either flips the strategy or helps somebody a lot. So we'll do our best to cover it all, and hopefully we can keep the number 9 up there, man.
Hey, Mike, there's still time to get your money in. So the smart money would be on this guy, Scott Dixon, the 5-time champion, but only once has he won the Indy 500.
Hey, you know about smart money, Marty, and you're dead on. In Vegas, that is the favorite right there. And he should be, Danica. He won the first 3 races of the year. There have been 6 races in the series. He's been top 5 of them. He reminds me of Tim Duncan, who I covered in the NBA. He's phenomenal, but it's not flamboyant. And in the racing world, it's like Jimmy Johnson, maybe, someone else, so like Dixie, you raced against. These are guys who are all-time greats, but don't get that notoriety necessarily. I would imagine there's a common theme you see in a guy like Jimmy Johnson in NASCAR and Scott Dixon here in IndyCar.
Yeah, they have a similar feel. I can tell you from the inside looking out, you never overlook them. You never overlook Jimmy Johnson. You never overlook Scott Dixon. They're incredible drivers. Now, maybe their personality doesn't drive as much media attention. Maybe they don't put their foot in his mouth as often as some of us other people. But they're driving on track, and the record book is completely different. And being on the inside, they're always fast.
Yeah, and he's in row one again. Another great chance for Scott Dixon to win a second Indy 500. Maybe it's going to be a young driver today. 7 drivers in the field. 25 or younger. Let's go back to the guys calling the race or something on those young men. Lee Diffie, who do you guys have your eye on coming into the race here today?
That's a good question, Mike. And there's 5 rookies. Keep in mind that this is the second fastest qualifying speed in the history of the Indianapolis 500. Speeds not seen in more than 2 decades. They are flying. And Paul, these youngsters are going to face a steep learning curve today, barreling down this front straight into turn 1. I know you remember your first Indianapolis 500. Which young driver do you like the look of? Who are you going to be paying attention to?
Well, Rinus VK got off to a really rocky start in IndyCars with 2 crashes on an oval, but he has looked phenomenal this week. He's coached and mentored by Ari Leyendyke Sr., and some would say he's got by far the fastest Chevy in the field. He might have the fastest car in the field right now.
Well, there you see Paul Rinus VK talking with the guy that I'd pick for a rookie to win this race, Alex Palou. Remarkable story. The only driver in this field that has no previous experience here at Indianapolis. He's taken to the track like a duck to water. He's rolling off 7th today. I just spoke to him a few minutes ago. He's incredibly confident. I said, describe your feeling in 1 word. He said, I'm dreaming.
And keep an eye on Pato Award from Arrow McLaren SP. You see there the Firestone Firehawks, the official tire of the NTT IndyCar Series. Time for a little Firestone one-on-one. What are we looking for today?
Well, look at the impact of the aero screen. That aero screen brings more weight, close to 65, 70 pounds high on the car. That puts more load on the tires. So tire degradation, tire wear over the course of 30 laps is going to be really important to watch.
And it is a warm day here in Indianapolis. Countdown is on. We are getting closer to the start of the Indianapolis 500.
The catalyst to any motorsport event is a dynamic pairing. Racing power is sparked by diehard batteries, half a century track record. Here at Indianapolis Motor Speedway, racing's prestige is spoken through a timeless phrase.
Gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen,
Gentlemen, start your engines. A trusted, powerful command whose words hold as much power as one of the most durable names in car batteries.
Back here in Indianapolis, that is outside of the track, and it gives you a sense of how much the Indy 500 means to these Hoosiers, to the people of this state. They still want to be a part of this, even though they can't be inside. In the next 10 minutes or so will look very familiar for those of you who've watched Indy over the years. A lot of the normal things that happen will happen right now. Let's go trackside for the pre-race ceremonies, emceed by Bob Jenkins.
For today's ceremonies, we welcome Dr. Will Robinson and Dr. Elvis Francois to provide the national anthem with the flyover provided by the Air Force Thunderbirds. But now we welcome Indianapolis Archbishop Charles C. Thompson for today's invocation.
Let us pray. God of all times and all ages, we turn to you this day to once again ask your divine blessing. In good times and in bad, you have shown us your loving kindness. In these last few months, we have experienced many disruptions, and we have a renewed vision of our brokenness. But we know with you at our side, that's not the end of our story, not the finish of the race for us. God of unity and new beginnings, bless us, our city, and our world with a peace and a unity that gives you glory. Help us to lift up the downtrodden and oppressed, and by your grace, lead us to a better tomorrow. Send down your blessing, too, upon these, the drivers, their teams, the officials, and fans on this 104th running of the Indianapolis 500. Keep all safe in your care. May those with us in person here today, along with all those who cannot be here, be united in joy over the many gifts you give us, our lives, our freedom, our faith, our brothers and sisters in the human family, and this, the greatest spectacle in racing. May God bless us all. May God bless America.
Stripes
and bright stars through the perilous fight. Oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air. They gave proof through the night that our flag was still.
Thunderbirds will be back, as well as back home again in Indiana, and the command to start the engines. All part of the tradition of the 104th Indianapolis 500. Still ahead on NBC.
There's over 100 years of risk and reward on the line, and it starts here today.
This is the greatest spectacle in racing, and today, one of these drivers will do something we will never, ever forget. There has not been an Andretti on the pole position at Indy for 33 years. Can Marco do it?
Checkered flag. Green.
Oh, we got a crash.
Get out.
Ferrucci threaded the needle.
Oh, my God.
What are we doing?
Whoa. Simon Pagenaud wins. He's made an Indy 500.
This is a moment he's dreamt about for a long time.
Here we are, Victor Lane, man! We did it! Yes!
NBC Sports welcomes you to the 2020 Indianapolis 500 presented by Firestone. It's not May, it's August, but it is still the weather and a story at Indianapolis. It is warm. The track temperature will go up. It's 84 degrees right now, 126 on this 2.5 mile oval, and the breeze continues to pick up. Mike Tirico, Danica Patrick with you on the sixth floor of the pagoda. Many of the ceremonies done, a few more still to come, and then it's race time. The drivers in those cars right now. But take me through the first couple of rows. Pick a couple of drivers you're thinking about right now.
Yeah, first row, Sato. His saying is no attack, no chance. I don't have to say anymore. Second row, Rinus VK. He's only been racing for 11 years. To me, that's ignorance is bliss here. You don't know what to expect, so you're just going to go for it. And everybody knows that. And in the next row is my pick, Rossi. I just think he's on a mission. He's my pick for this year. We're going to see it from lap one, corner one.
What are the drivers going through right now as they're sitting in the cars knowing that the command to start engines is just a moment or two away?
This is that point in time where you don't think about the fans anymore. So regardless of the year, this is that focused point where you're checking your helmet, you're checking your belts, you're checking your radio, you're checking your drink tube, you're making sure that you can hear everyone. And then all you're doing is you're looking at your right front. Well, actually, pause. Right before that, you're probably saying a little special request with your eyes closed. To whoever you want to say that to, and then you're looking at your right front waiting for the command.
And there is Mario Andretti in front with son Michael behind. Gonna have a great moment with Mario, Michael, and Marco on the pole. The three Andrettis will lead them into turn one as we get started. And now for another Indy 500 tradition to sing back home again in Indiana, Mr. Jim Cornelison.
Back home again.
it seems that I can see the gleaming candlelight still shining bright through the sycamores for me. The new moon hay sends all its fragrance from the fields I used to roam. When I dream about the moonlight on the Wabash, then I long for my Indiana home.
I want that video.
Back home again in Indiana.
Race fans around the world, thank you for joining us for the 104th running of the Indianapolis 500. This is a special day for me and the Penske family as we begin the stewardship of this iconic speedway. I want to thank the Holman George family for 75 years of leadership. Also, the passionate fans who are not here today, but guess what? We'll be back home in Indiana in 2021. Be safe, have fun. Drivers, start your engines.
The command from the captain, that second flyover for all of you in Indiana who make this so special. Stand by, the Indy 500 is next. Over a century of racing here, this 2.5 mile oval used to be covered by bricks. These grandstands are usually crowded by great race fans. Things change, but this is still the same. This is as important a title as there is in motorsports. Someone will win the Indianapolis 500 over the next couple of hours, and you're in no better hands to document it all than the voice of our IndyCar series on NBC. Here's Lee Diffie. Diff.
Mike, thanks so much. What a lead-in. What a build-up to this 104th running, and what a treat we have for you folks. Look to the bottom of your screens there. You see the Honda two-seater. It's affectionately known as the fastest seat in sport, and it typically and traditionally leads the field ahead of the pace car to the green. Well, this is an historic treat. If you haven't heard about it, inside that Honda two-seater is legend Mario Andretti. There he is. That's not unusual. This is Mario's passion. Even in his early 80s, he still loves driving this. And he does it for many. He's done it for thousands over the years. But in the back of it is his 1991 IndyCar championship-winning son, Michael, who has had success here, not as a driver, but as a team owner. Michael's won this race 5 times as an owner. And it keeps on going through the generations of the Andretti family, because then one step further back behind Mark Royce in the pace car is Marco. So 3 Andretti's on the track at the one time. That's not unusual here as far as the Andretti history is concerned, but for Mario, Michael and Marco, it most certainly is. And 60 Indy 500 starts across the 3 generations. Fantastic. I mentioned Mark Royce, the president of General Motors. Mark is behind the wheel. There he is right there, of the brand new Corvette Stingray, to lead this field to green. And for more information on this beautiful car, you can go to Chevy.com. You've got the president right behind the wheel. an exciting time for him as well, especially to be wedged in between the generations of Andretti family members and drivers. Time now to take a look at the Firestone starting grid for this year's Indy 500, and it certainly is interesting. We know about the historic pole for Marco. It was so tight, the difference between himself and Scott Dixon. And Takuma Sato, the 2017 winner of this race, Townsend starts on the front row for the very first time.
Always exciting with Sato. Look for him to try to shoot wide around Scott Dixon, but Scott Dixon and that orange and blue car will be a force today. He's put himself in all kinds of uncomfortable positions in practice. That'll be really important because I think you're going to be uncomfortable all day in traffic. Looking down to row three there, Alexander Rossi starting outside. That's a huge benefit here at Indy because going wide and going high early is your best chance to make some moves.
Paul, as we walk our way through the field and the Firestone starting grid, who catches your eye? Get back to PT in just a moment. Felix Rosenquist is right there. Jack Harvey, Santino Ferrucci on the seventh row, last year's Rookie of the Year here at the 500.
Did a great job. So much muscle there in row 8 and 9. Tony Kanaan, his 19th Indy 500 start. He knows how to lead. He also knows how to go big on the start. And last year's winner, can you believe it? Simon Pagenaud, row 9. Terrible qualifying result.
And Elio Castroneves, in his 20th Indy 500 start, is on the 10th row in a very unfamiliar position. However, he's feeling good. He said, I can come through the field. I've done it before here at the Brickyard to perhaps score that historic fourth victory. We're pleased to say that we've got 14 onboard cameras for you, and we're going to use them a lot today. This is Joseph Newgarden, the two-time and defending series champion. With thanks to Shell V-Power, we'll have this view of the number one car. How about one of five rookies? Not a rookie to the series, but a rookie to Indianapolis. He failed to qualify last year. That's Pato O'Ward. With thanks to Arrow Electronics, we'll have this view. And his young teammate and fellow rookie, Mission Foods, brings us this view of Oliver Askew in the number 7 Arrow McLaren SP car. The veteran, the five-time champion, and one of the overwhelming favorites, Scott Dixon, with thanks to Honda. Muddy.
Hey, Lee, when I sat down with Scott Dixon yesterday, he said this is a different pace in 2020 for us for the Indy 500. He said, honestly, coming into the race the last few years, I knew we didn't have a car that was fast enough or the drivability to win the race. Today, I have all of that. Scott Dixon might have the best car he's ever had for an Indy 500, Lee.
And how about his teammate Felix Rosenquist, second-year starter here at the 500 with thanks to NTT Data. He'll give us some good views today, and so too will Graham Rahal in the United Rentals, Rahal, Letterman, Lanigan, Honda, with thanks to United Rentals right there. Santino Ferrucci, courtesy of Honda in the Dale Coyne with Vassar Sullivan entry. And then the Menards, a very recognizable Menards Chevrolet of Simon Pagenaud. Kelly? Kevin?
And Lee, Simon Pagenaud starts 25th. In the last 83 years, there's only been one driver starting this far back that's won the 500. But Simon told me if the balance is there, and it is, I can win the 500 for a second straight year.
We look forward to that. With thanks to Gainbridge, Zach Veach will give us this view. We're getting close to the start of the race. Auto Nation brings us Alexander Rossi's onboard camera, and we are excited about that. U.S. Air Force. And Connor Daly, what can he do today? Jack Harvey, with thanks to AutoNation, SiriusXM, Fernando Alonso, and many others. Well, there's never been one like this before. Never in August, never with no fans. But it is, and always will be, the greatest spectacle in racing. This is the Indianapolis 500.
Get ready.
And there is a 33-year-old Andretti leading the field of 33. But Marco is challenged by Dixon early. That orange and blue car going around the outside. Dixon for the lead and gets it.
Clear.
Bold move from Scott Dixon around the outside. Hey, Paul, what's it like over there?
Jostling for position. Alex Palou trying there. Takuma Sato now makes a move on Marco Andretti for second, and Ryan Hunter-Reay in that yellow and red DHL Honda, he's on the move as well.
Lee, Scott Dixon is checking out right now. Amazing acceleration
from that PNC car on the start. It looked like Marco had a good jump. Further back now, there's Hunter Ray in the yellow and red DHL car. He's going to the inside of his teammate. Marco says, not yet, buddy, and not now.
And Rinus VK is there, the 19-year-old Dutch driver in that 21, that white and black Sonac Chevrolet. He is not daunted by this rookie experience.
James Hinchcliffe drafting up on the rookie VK. James in that orange and white Genesis car, looking to the inside, tucks back in. He'll look for a draft coming out of turn four, back onto the front straight.
And there's Alexander Rossi, the blue and yellow Napa Auto Parts Honda. He's staying in the mix. So too is Spencer Pigot in the high V Honda. And Marcus Ericsson is there as they start to find a rhythm now. And look at this, Sato has caught up to Dixon. Inside is James Hinchcliffe on the rookie. Couldn't quite do it.
Oh!
Ed Carpenter, U.S. Space Force car. Kelly?
Yeah, trouble for the local guy, Ed Carpenter, early. He's really upset with Zach Veach. He says Veach put him into the wall early, and it sounds like they might have to make a front wing change as they assess
sorry,
the damage.
Guys.
But trouble early for Ed Carpenter.
Take a look at the replay.
He had to have known I was there.
It's the view from Jack Harvey's car. Whoa.
So you could hear Ed Carpenter say he had to have known I was there. Perhaps information from the spotter for Veach, but tough to say. It's so hard to try to stick your nose into that short chute on the start. The action furious right here out of the beginning. You can tell, Lee, the urgency, the anxiety to try to make something happen on the start, because it's very difficult after a few laps with the turbulent air as soon as the tires start to wear.
Look out, here comes Captain America, Ryan Hunter-Reay, in that red and yellow DHL Honda for Andretti Autosport. This is as good as we have seen him here at the Speedway in a while. And he is all over to Takuma Sato.
Huge runoff of turn four for Hunter-Reay. He had great balance through turn four. Should be an easy pass down the front straightaway. He tucks into second. Now Hunter-Reay has Dixon in his sights.
Who said it was going to be tough to pass this year? Beautiful move from RHR. Dixon, Hunter-Reay, Sato, Andretti, the rookie VK, Hinchcliffe, Rossi, Spencer Pigot, Marcus Ericsson, and Graham Rahal.
Marco Andretti has fell back a little bit, just settling in now to fourth place as Dixon now leading Hunter-Reay, stalking. Sato looking good.
I was talking with Hunter-Reay and Alexander Rossi just before the start this morning, and they both said that you really have to embrace being uncomfortable today. It's important to have your car set up loose as VK moves to the inside there. Hinchcliffe all over the back. Looks like we've got a problem.
James Davison.
Right front.
Yeah, he's hit the wall. It looks like the brake is on fire.
Oh, my gosh.
The wheel's come apart. The whole wheel is broken apart. So I've never seen anything like that before.
Right front wheel's going to come off in a second. Get him low. Get him low. Get it off the track. Yep.
James Davison in the Dale Coyne entry with Rick Ware Racing, Bird and Bilotti entry.
Wow.
That is wild. I've never, ever seen. I don't know why he just doesn't stop.
Well, if you can get to pit lane and they can figure out how to get that wheel off, Paul, I'm sure. Oh, now the whole car's going to light up.
That's a big fire. He needs to get out of that car really quickly right now.
This is Australia's James Davison in his sixth Indianapolis 500. And it is over pretty much as quick as it started. What a shame.
Magnesium wheels. You can see the...
Doesn't look like Townsend, he brushed the wall, because there's no mark on the outside, and that wheel looks as though it just broke apart in the center. They're magnesium, and you've got to crack check these wheels. They do that frequently after every race, and maybe that wheel just came apart, and then that magnesium will catch fire.
Paul, I wonder if it started with rotor temperature. You can see the brake rotor.
Yeah, it's like it's
glowing.
Locked on. But you would think if the brakes were locked on, it would just skid the tire. But never seen anything like that before.
Maybe something stuck in there generated so much rotor temperature.
Oh
and then it exploded right there, the wheel. So something horribly wrong with the rotor and drag with the caliper, and Davison must be in complete shock. Like, what in the world just happened?
He has been on a wild ride lately, mixing IndyCar with NASCAR Cup Series. He qualified here last weekend, jumped on a jet, went down to Daytona International Speedway, competed in the NASCAR Cup Series road course race there, then flew back to Indy. It has been an interesting year, but nothing quite like that.
Crazy scenes. And the first yellow. Great to see the AMR safety team there on the spot. Very quick to aid James Davison. You saw this group of cars pitting in non-stop, and Simon Pagenaud, the defending Indianapolis 500 winner, is at the head of this pack. Not everyone came, but a small select group, most notably those at the back third of the pack, as we check out Pagenaud's Menards onboard Townsend. So those who knew they were in a difficult position anyway decided to roll the dice. Let's go.
Yeah, you could do it now on five more stops, so that puts you in the window to make it to the end. And stopping early puts you in the strategy and go to the end. There you see the fuel windows. We'll be back.
You're watching NBC's coverage of the Indy 500. Brought to you by Firestone. Drive the tire that drives IndyCar legends. Liberty Mutual Insurance. Only pay for what you need. Guaranteed rate. Mortgage rates are historically low. Visit rate.com today. And by Die Hard Batteries, now available at Advance Auto Parts.
And you see the number 20 car of Ed Carpenter still on pit road from that early incident with Zach Veach. The damage to this U.S. Space Force car a little bit more significant than they initially estimated. They changed that front week, but there is suspension damage they've also had to work on. So just a disappointing start for Ed in his 17th Indianapolis 500 start. And by the way, that incident was reviewed by IndyCar between Carpenter and Veach. No action is taken. Rutledge.
Kelly, there's so many fan favorites like Ed Carpenter here, and we got some from the museum. Take a quick look. This is Allenser Sr.'s 50th anniversary car. Right next to that, Johnny Rutherford's win from 1980, 40th anniversary, and Jacques Villeneuve's 25th anniversary car. So many amazing pieces of history here at the museum, Kelly, that fans can come by, see anytime. But amazing to see the difference in these cars and what's on the track today, guys.
Cool to take a walk down memory lane there, Rut. Thanks so much for that. Feel for Ed Carpenter. Had high hopes here. He has the four-star General John Raymond, Chief of Space Operations for the U.S. Space Force, here as a guest. Really wanted to perform well with the car in U.S. Space Force colors for the very first time. I tell you what, guys, Ryan Hunter-Reay was on a mission before this first caution of the race. He was catching Dixon very quickly.
Yes, but these guys at the back that have pitted Townsend have really changed the complexity of the race. These guys are going to have to pit about 8 to 10 laps short of these other guys, and everything can change now if another yellow comes out and it cycles that group that pitted in the back to the front. So this is going to get wilder and wilder as we go on, as these guys are getting ready to come to green.
And we won't find out for a while if that strategy plays off as Dixon rolls into that Honda power coming off a four.
The 2008 Indy 500 winner leads the field back to green. But let's see what Hunter-Reay's got early on here. Marco Andretti is trying to get something on Takuma Sato, and James Hinchcliffe in the orange Genesis car is wheel to wheel with Rinus VK through one.
Newgarden was on the outside of a four car wide. Guys are three wide coming around one as they come by me here in two.
Silver.
There's James Hinchcliffe way on the outside right there.
Rookie Rinus VK in that 21 car. And here
one
comes Rossi.
Two, now three wide middle.
Watch
all
the
clear.
Run. Rossi has teammate Hinchcliffe.
VK doesn't give up on the outside. He goes for an outside move with a clean track.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. And then he tucked back in behind James Hinchcliffe.
Rossi told me this morning that VK's been writing checks that he's not sure VK can cash. He is bold and brave in his rookie Indy 500 as Rossi tries to chase him down. And further back, it looks like Tony Kanaan going three wide.
Tony Kanaan and Veach zigzagging there with Alex Palou, the rookie, in the purple Dale Coyne car.
Power and Pagenaud nearly touched wheels on the front straight. Side by side, they come around the short shoot. Power makes the move on the outside.
Paul, we're only 14 laps in, but the urgency, I think, is higher than I've ever seen to make moves happen now. If you're going to win today, you've got to start getting to the front from deep in the field.
James Hinchcliffe just saw he got passed in turn three, falling back a little bit. Marco Andretti right there, back up to fourth place. But the action is really frantic in the back. Hunter-Reay got a nice draft, but I think right now he's content to just ride.
just chaos on that restart, guys. And I talked to Alexander Rossi earlier this week about these restarts, and he said, you kind of at Indy on restarts have to throw out the parameters of really what you should and should not be able to do. He said, you have to approach the restart. You're approaching it so much slower that you can take way more risks. That's why I've made those crazy moves over the years. And Townsend, you're right. It's going to be an absolute fight to get in those first four spots, because once you get in that top four, that's when you can really make moves and challenge Scott Dixon, who's led every lap so far.
Hinchcliffe making a move. Another teammate, Marco Andretti. Marco goes back to fifth place. Hinch is going forward.
I think the preferred thing for these three teammates, Rossi, Andretti, and Hinchcliffe, would be to work together, but they have Rossi, or they have DK stuck in the middle of them, and he's not given any quarters. Rossi gets by, and Erickson on the inside, but look at VK trying to make a move back on the outside. He's resisting. The kid's aggressive.
He's fighting, isn't he? He's resisting those moves. He may not have a choice here as the Husky Chocolate Honda.
Get that back in here,
red Chip Ganassi car is ready to make a move. That's Marcus Erickson, second year here at the Indy 500.
Speaking of Honda, Diff, Honda now in the top six. VK, the first Chevrolet. The next one down in 12th with Pato O'Ward. Honda dominated qualifying, and so far flexing big muscles here in the opening laps.
Well, you see that second Chevrolet there of Pato O'Ward in 12th. He's starting to make his way forward. He started 15th, so he's made up three since the start. That's a good move. He's chasing down Alex Palou in the Dale Coyne with Team Go Car. I misidentified him before, by the way. It was Jack Harvey a little further back, dicing with Kanaan and Veach.
Got four Andretti cars now placed in the top six, and if they can displace Sato and they can start working together and forcing Dixon to sit out front, they could have the upper hand here as the race goes on, Townsend.
Paul, you had mentioned Newgarden going big on the start. Let's take a look at his onboard. Makes a move on O'Ward here. Palou to the inside, just ahead. What is he doing turn one? Oh, very tenderly works the throttle up in the light gray. So that's the respect you have to show when you're out of the groove, running high. That number one Team Penske car, Kelly, is up to 14th and looking to keep moving up.
Yeah, Joseph Newgarden has felt really good about his race car. So good, in fact, that during that final practice on carb day, he told me after 30 minutes, he basically wanted to pack the car up and push it back to the garage. This guy has been relaxed every time I've seen him, focused, but full of confidence in this race car. However, they really haven't been able to move forward. He qualified 13th, as you said, running 14th right now. So we'll have to see if they can make some moves later on in this run.
Little gap right now to that pack of cars just in front of him. So needs to be able to just pull up on that group, get a little bit better fuel mileage. He's got Connor Daly kind of right in his toe behind him as well.
14th place at the moment for Joseph Newgarden in the Shell V-Power Chevrolet. He was the highest qualifying Team Penske car in a very unusual Indy 500 qualifying weekend, as Hunter Ray just shadowing race leader Scott Dixon. Dixon has led all 19 laps thus far. He, as we said earlier, was the overwhelming favorite coming into today's race in the PNC Bank Honda. So far, so good for the Kiwi. Tonight, the Stanley Cup playoffs are on NBC. Two of the NHL's top goal-scoring teams face off in prime time. Bruins Lightning. There's nothing like playoff hockey. That's tonight at 8 Eastern. Nothing like the five-time champion Scott Dixon leading the way. And you know how he's chasing AJ Foyt for the most championships won in the NTT IndyCar Series? Well, he has just tied AJ Foyt for the most Indy 500s led. It means they've both led in 13 Indianapolis 500s, only headed by Tony Kanaan, who has 14. Marty?
And Lee up front, don't be surprised if Scott Dixon lets Ryan Hunter Ray go, because when you're out front, you use a lot more fuel. And a yellow on the track, Lee.
For no obvious reason, just yet. There's a big obvious reason. Marcus Erickson.
That's a big crash right there, I believe.
Paul, Marcus Erickson had been working
hard
to
right
get
in
around
front
DK.
Of me
now
here.
The car lights up, Paul. What do you see?
I'm right on top of it. His car is on fire, but it's just a turbo fire. There's oil in the exhaust, but big impact here. Both the whole side of the car, both wheels, headers are now on fire. Got an oil line loose as Marcus now is jumping out. He's literally right underneath me. And I'll head outside here real quick. Get a quick look here, but you can see he's climbing out right now.
What a shame, because Marcus Ericsson had such a positive week and a half. He's got that special tribute Ronnie Peterson helmet, one of two Swedish drivers in this race, and he had been quick. He'd been quick in practice. He'd been good in qualifying, Kelly. It's all over now, and it's another non-finish.
Yeah, huge disappointment. Even just moments before that wreck, Marcus Ericsson came over the radio to say that he felt really good about his race car, the balance was good, and that he was starting to find his rhythm. And then obviously misfortune struck this Swede, who will be sorely disappointed in his second Indy 500 outing.
He's had a great season going so far, Lee, and this has got to be a big disappointment. As he's coming off of turn two here right in front of me. Oh, it gets a little bit loose right there. And just flat pancakes the wall in turn one. And then it slid all the way over to where I was, and it stopped literally right underneath me.
That was a massive hit. Big tank slapper in the dirty air. Ericsson had been working hard to try to make some ground on VK and stay up with the leaders. It's quite shocking that he would be in that kind of situation, getting that loose that far back from another car. I think that just goes to show how difficult it is to trail another car in front with the turbulent air. And for Ericsson, glad to see him get out and walk away. That was a massive impact. Hit.
And that camera shot was Paul's handheld camera from his balcony out there in the turn two suites. Thanks to the Indianapolis Colts, by the way, for allowing PT to be in that suite. What did you make of that, Danica?
Turn two is always a tough one. As a driver, you know, the line is so fine, and it looked to me like he got offline, he got a little high, he got loose. There's a little bump right in the middle of two, and that can catch you off guard if the car is off just a little bit. It caught me off guard.
A shame for Marcus Ericsson, who came into this race and this round of the NTC IndyCar Series in the top 10 in points. He crashed on pit lane last year on entry, and he had said he had learned so much in the past year just being full-time. Of course, he had 5 years in Formula One before coming to IndyCar, and he was ready, he was primed, and he'd shown that over the course of the past week and a bit. Not to be for this man's teammate.
I believe all these guys are going to pit, and all those early pitters, Townsend, are now going to cycle to the front for their turn at the front.
You bet.
And when we talk about those who pitted early, there they are, and the biggest movers, the Firestone biggest movers of the race. But you've got Oliver Askew, Will Power, Simon Pagenaud, Alonso, Castro Neves, Kimball, Chilton, Karam and Hanley were all those early pitters. So we will see. It's going to mix things up a little bit.
Busy pit lane, and there's always a lot of nervous action on pit lane, Townsend. We've had a lot of mistakes on pit road, and this pit road is tight as anything in the business.
And Paul, that's a great point. Such a tight pit road. Everybody going to try and mind their P's and Q's here. Takuma Sato started third. He is in third right now, saying the car has too much understeer. They're going to make a wing adjustment. Meanwhile, Ryan Hunter-Reay and Scott Dixon both said they were impressed with the mileage they were able to get. Ryan Hunter-Reay said, hey, if we can do that all day long and make the numbers we need to make, I'm very happy. No changes on the wing or air pressure for Ryan Hunter-Reay. Same for Scott Dixon, who was very happy with the car and about to give up the lead to Hunter-Reay just to make sure they can save a little bit of fuel. Dixon going to use that second pit stall, and he will win the Firestone race off pit road here. And a tight race there by a bunch of guys further back.
Oh boy, that was close between Ryan Hunter-Reay and James Hinchcliffe. I think Hunter-Reay had to get on the brakes to avoid his teammate in the Firestone race off pit road. And there were lots of takers there. Virtually the whole field hit it.
You're watching NBC's coverage of the Indy 500, brought to you by Honda, an official vehicle of the NTT IndyCar Series. Gainbridge, protect and grow your savings with confidence. Learn more at gainbridge.life. And by United Rentals, official equipment rental services provider of Rahal Letterman Lanigan and sponsor of Graham Rahal.
Lap 30 of 200. We are under yellow after the Marcus Ericsson crash. Mike Tirico, Danica Patrick, our Indy 500 team here on NBC. A couple of yellows here early on. What does that do for the drivers? What does it do for the teams, maybe more importantly?
Well, it definitely allows you to be able to shake it up as far as the strategy goes, but it also allows you to improve on your car. You can come in and get front wing, take it out. There's just a lot of options that open up for you if you're a little bit off. So we might see a lot of shuffling around after these restarts just because somebody's able to improve on their car. But of course, nothing compares to the ability to be able to be fast and then have a pit crew that's equally as fast and gets you out of the pits in under 7 seconds as Scott Dixon did. Incredible, incredible team.
That's part of the story throughout this season. Again, a reminder for those who have not been watching the NTT IndyCar Series throughout the year. Six races, Dixon in the top five times, including winning the first three races. He's been the dominant one, the favorite coming in. Strong performance so far. As they continue to work on the track, before we go back to green, we go to Rutledge Wood.
Mike, we know fans here at Indianapolis Motor Speedway have so much dedication, and one fan was watching practice and he said, hey, I think somebody's backyard backs up to that gap in the fence and the seating in turn three. He goes and knocks on the door, strikes up a deal, about $400 plus wood later. He's got his very own platform and his own seat here to watch a race at IMS. These fans have been out here anywhere they could find all weekend long. Tons of dedication, Mike.
Thank you, Rutt. We'll head back up to Lee Diffie as we get ready. Lee, there is Joe, the man with a plan, and he pulled it off in grand style. His chance to keep his streak going, though. Doug Bowles, the president of Indianapolis Motor Speedway, told all the fans who usually come and say, I've been to 25, I've been to 27 in a row. If you're watching on TV, it counts and your streak rolls on.
That was dedicated and certified in a proclamation from the president of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, wasn't it? And he said, I've never done this before in my 7 years of leadership, but I'm doing it today because the fans mean so much. You mean so much to this venue, to this series, to all of us, and we miss you dearly. It doesn't feel the same without you. It feels quite strange, to be honest. But we will get a good race here, and it's already given us something pretty interesting, right, Paul?
I think Pagano right now is ready to go. I think he wants to work his way to the front right here with his teammate, Will Power, and then them work together. This is the great opportunity that he has right now to go two in a row. Look at him. He's right up the bottom back.
Think about Oliver Askew in this Arrow McLaren SP car right at the front. He won the Indy Lights race here a year ago. He is going to lead the defending Indy 500
green,
winner
green,
back
green.
To green.
Well, he's not going to lead for long because that was a masterful restart, and Pagano's going to be by before they even hit the start-finish line.
Look at the field behind him, six wide. Further back, you've got seven Chevrolet cars to lead the restart, and then a bunch of angry fast Hondas coming. Look at Dixon getting checked up there.
He's trying to get around Ben Hanley in the Dragon Speed entry. Zach Veach is coming up on Takuma Sato. Dixon tucks back in. Veach goes around the outside.
Three wide, coming onto the back straightaway in the back. Look at these guys in the back here. It's craziness.
All jostling for position. And again, Rossi ducks out. Rossi's working Dixon there, gets around Ben Hanley. Andretti's tucked in behind. So too Hunter Ray, and then the teenage rookie Rinus VK.
Got the slowest car in the field with Ben Hanley doing his best to try to stay out of trouble.
This is a time when you gotta just settle in. These guys driving crazy on the front straightaway, right up against the wall. You can get yourself down to, you know, in trouble early.
Here it comes, VK to the high side. Hunter Ray in front of Marco Andretti. And look at Santino Ferrucci in that bright yellow Sealmaster car going to the outside of Joseph Newgard. They'll go two wide through turn two.
Nothing is frightening. Rinus VK, the 19-year-old from the Netherlands, in his first Indy 500, is pulling off moves of a veteran, and he does another one there, inside on Ben Hanley.
But stark contrast to the vets and these new young guns that are in the IndyCar Series. Santino Ferrucci comes around the outside of Hinchcliffe. Outside pass.
I thought Hinchcliffe might back out of it there in the short shoot, but Ferrucci stayed with it, Hinch stayed with it, and now they get a big run down the front straightaway. I'll tell you, Dixon really was able to get away from Hunter Ray. There's Ferrucci on another move.
On Pato Award.
He was right up against the wall, inches from the wall.
I gotta say, he flagged this. He told me 2 days ago, he said, Diff, are you ready for some outside moves? Because I'm gonna execute them. I'm not happy with where I qualified. I'm gonna put on a show for you guys.
He's certainly been frustrated, Townsend, with being outrun by his rookie teammate, Pelot, but he's gotten by him. There's Pelot right there, about eight or nine positions behind his teammate, and he is really making some strong moves.
Joseph Newgard there in the red-white car has his hands full. That's Colton Herta in the white orange and light blue car all over the back, followed by Alex Palou. So all kinds of action. Connor Daly being passed by Tony Kanaan into turn one.
Santino's looking for a move on Marco Andretti now as he's trying to set it up off one and two.
Riding there with Connor Daly in the U.S. Air Force Chevrolet. Daly is a little further back. He's in 23rd position at the moment. Andretti on the inside of Ben Hanley.
Ben Hanley's just got to hang on here. He started all the way in the back. He's a journeyman driver, does a lot of sports car racing all over the world, and now he's, Townsend, shoved right to the front of the pack, and he's just got to survive this and get the experience.
He's got to survive, and so do some of these faster cars like Santino Ferrucci. They've lost about 6 seconds to guys like Scott Dixon, who made moves early. Kelly, what's going on down there?
Well, Townsend, Marcus Ericsson has now been released from the infield care center, disappointed for sure. I heard you, Marcus, say you were finding your rhythm, the car felt good. What led into that crash?
Yeah, I'm not sure. We need to look at the data there and see how it happened. The car was feeling really, really good. The Husky Chocolate Honda, you know, was on rails, and we were making progress on during that first stint. And yeah, I was feeling really, really, really good out there. So it sort of took me by surprise that rear stepping out on me and almost catched it, but couldn't really. And yeah, that was the end of the day.
You're so confident coming into this race. I can't imagine what it feels like to be out of it this early.
Yeah, I mean, especially when you have such a good car, you know, I really felt like we had a car to fight for the win today. And I think I showed that in the first 25 laps, you know, that we really was making progress, and I felt so good out there. So just makes it even tougher, you know, and even more disappointing.
Thank you, Marcus.
Marcus Ericsson out of his second Indianapolis 500. This man, the second car in shot, the Sonac Chevrolet, is Rinus VK. His real name is Rinus von Kalmthout, but he made life easy on broadcasters like us by just saying Rinus VK will do. And there's a Dutch driver in Formula One who we all know by Max Verstappen. There he is on the right, and that's Rinus VK on the left. That's nearly 10 years ago. Two Dutch kids doing great on the world scene.
And no doubt everybody in the Netherlands pulling for Rinus VK today. You can see the passion in his eyes, but he admitted to me before the race, I'm a little nervous. I think those nerves have gone out the window. And Lee, you talked about those daring moves that he's willing to make. That eventually makes other drivers in the field not so happy. So we'll see if he can continue to show that speed and that bravery all afternoon long.
Indy 500 vet J.R. Hildebrand leading this group, but Hunter Ray right there had a bad pit stop, and it kind of cycled him back to 10th, but he hasn't really moved forward.
Simon Pagenaud, the defending Indy 500 race winner, leads the way over Oliver Askew and Will Power, Charlie Kimball, and Helio Castroneves. Those five cars are off strategy in comparison to the man who dominated the early phase of this race, Scott Dixon, who runs in sixth. But Pagenaud out in front and in control. Boy, the signs of 2019. We'll see. Lost Speedways, the new Peacock original documentary series hosted by Dale Earnhardt Jr. with co-host Matthew Dillner, is an exploratory journey that spans the entire country as the pair uncover great racing cathedrals of the past and stories hidden there. All episodes of Lost Speedways are now streaming completely free, exclusively on Peacock, and you can sign up at peacocktv.com today. To Kevin Lee, Kev?
Diff, last year's winner Simon Pagenaud, starting in 25th, said, we just got to figure out a way to get clean air. Well, by pitting early under that first caution, they cycled to the front. They got it. He's taken off, but he's picked up a vibration here in the last couple of laps and really wants to get to that first pit stop. Meanwhile, Oliver Askew right behind him did a three-wide pass on the last restart to get by Will Power and Simon Pagenaud, and it was fun to watch and also listen to on the radio.
All right, bud, looking good. You'll be all clear down here. Champion strategy, man. Think like one. You're all clear behind. No pressure. Just keep doing what you're doing. You're sticking right with Simon. Keep it up. Nice job.
He said he used to get super nervous and even stop racing as a kid, but somehow, after taking a year off and went back, no nerves coming into this 500, Marty. Oliver Askew is second as a rookie.
Boy, Kevin, you never know when strategy in a race can flip. It could be lap 8 for the 2020 Indy 500. Simon Pagenaud, Will Power, Helio Castroneves, all of these guys pitting right here while everybody else, Scott Dixon, Alexander Rossi, they've got another 10 laps on the track at least, so we're going to see this all day long, Kevin.
So Simon Pagenaud was planning on going about 3 laps longer. Oliver Askew was told, come in when the leader comes in. So the top two are in. front wing adjustment there you see on Menard Chevrolet, and Pagenaud is out, but Askew beat him with a quicker stop.
Tell you what, those McLaren guys are very fast in the pit lane. They just beat Team Penske. Unbelievable.
Well, interestingly enough, Billy Vincent is the strategist, Townsend, for Oliver Askew at Arrow McLaren SP. He used to work at Team Penske.
He knows all the tricks of the trade. As Askew comes off the pit speed limiter, now this is where you really have to hustle. Tough as a rookie. He'll just duck the right sides over that white line, try to maximize the radius as Castroneves comes in. Down to you, Kevin.
So Elio Castroneves said, I'm doing something very different than everyone else. It's either going to work well, and we'll have a chance to win, or I'm going to sink like a rock. So far, he's been pretty stationary. Real quick stop, though, for the Pennzoil number three Penske team.
Right now, power stays out. We'll be looking for him anytime soon as Kimball follows him, and Dixon now has cycled his way back to third and will pick up the lead when Power and Kimball pit. So everything going to plan right now as I think Power's coming in, followed by Kimball.
Oh, Will Power just about loses the back end of that Verizon Chevy as he comes to the line.
Will Power, they made an adjustment to the wing. His first pit stop on lap eight. Will Power now up in clean air. He had been running third, then pitted from the lead. He said no changes this time around. They've had a lot of pit miscues this season, looking for some good clean stops here today.
It's a fast stop. Dixon now back to the point, followed by Rossi. And the way it's looking now, this is going to be a dogfight, I think, between Dixon and Rossi all the way, at least for the next 150 miles.
And all four Penske cars on a different strategy, albeit three of them by one lap, and then you got Newgarden on a different one totally. So we'll see how that works, because there's Simon Pagenaud, there's Elio Castroneves, who was able to not leapfrog Simon Pagenaud, and here comes the other two guys on that different strategy. Scott Dixon.
Here's the issue, guys. Scott Dixon is looking just down the road now at lapping Pagenaud and Power, who just came out of the pits in front of him. So you can almost go a lap down here on a pit stop, Townsend.
I was going to say, Paul, yeah, you have to be within 5 seconds of the leader, or if you're the leader, the guy who's going to take the lead cannot be further than 5 seconds or closer than 5 seconds to you, or you could go down a lap. Simon Pagenaud right now, 33 seconds behind, so he is about to go a lap down if Dixon can lay down some laps right here. But Dixon said when he was leading out front, he was happy with the fuel consumption. With all this aero screen, the new aero screen that's on the car, it is really a penalty to be out front and lead. If you're Alexander Rossi riding behind him, you can save much more fuel.
Yeah, I think Scott Dixon's going to want to try to save as much as he can, as well as Rossi, who's going to be content to save fuel. So I don't think they're going to try to push the issue, but Pagenaud Power, they've got to go flat out, Townsend, because you don't want to get lapped here.
Riding aboard Alexander Rossi with the AutoNation onboard camera. T-Bell, take us for a ride. Tell us about how you get around the speedway.
Well, you're still going to pick up turbulent air this far back from Scott Dixon, so you want to arc it up high, try to get late to the apex in turn one, especially as the wind's picking up. With the crosswind in two, get in early, get your left front down below that white line. That's where all the grip is. Now grab the gears, try to follow the draft of Scott Dixon. Let's listen to see if Rossi saves any fuel here.
Clicked it up into sixth gear there, back down to fifth. So not flat out all the way around the track right now. You hear him breathe it in about every corner and downshift.
It's a little bit of a moment there. Had to check up coming off of turn four.
He's got 6 seconds in front of him now.
Nice run coming down the front straightaway. I think Dixon's saving fuel at this point. Rossi checking up. So Dixon knows I've got the lead. I just keep Rossi where he is, but I don't want to burn more fuel than I have to, because I bet Rossi doesn't want to lead at this point in the race either. Remember, the less fuel you use, the shorter the pit stop to refill it on pit lane.
By the way, who won the competition at home? We are thinking of you, the fans, and that competition is, I've done it myself when watching the 500. Who picked Dixon to be leading at lap 50, quarter race distance? If you did, congratulations. That was a wise choice. He has led the most laps in the race thus far. Nothing like these amazing images of the famed Brickyard. And today's aerial coverage is brought to you by Guaranteed Rate. It sure looks different, doesn't it? With no fans in the stands, we miss you. The race goes on, and as many have been saying, this is the race that the pandemic could not, would not stop. And we're pleased about that. Scott Dixon is pleased to have led 36 laps so far. Let's take you back just a few short moments ago and some radio for Dixon.
Fuel position 5 now with the sequence. Now we're in you and Rossi. Tell us about the car.
Yeah, I just feel light. Front and rear about belt.
Feels a little light, Townsend, on downforce. He's got that narrow center wicker. We've heard some chatter about the guys that have the full long wicker maybe feeling they're a little bit too over downforce. Like Ferrucci said, I can't get by when it strings out, but on the restarts, he can really make some moves.
He can, and when he's out front in clean air, he seems to be making great speed, and I think pretty comfortable on where they stand fuel-wise, but now the challenge is catching lap traffic as Scott Dixon's coming up on Ed Carpenter, who is 13 laps down after the contact on the start with the wall. And this is where you're really looking for some favors. These guys are their friends and neighbors here in Indianapolis, but it's going to be tough for Dixon to try to make a move. He's been able to open up a gap of about a second and a half over Rossi, but that's going to quickly dissipate, Marty.
Dixon right now, Marty's running about 2-3 miles an hour faster than Pagano, and he's starting to close that gap. If he can get by Ed right here, the gap is steadily closing down.
And Paul, catching that traffic might force Dixon to pit road a little bit earlier. They're planning on coming here in about 4 laps. Meanwhile, Takuma Sato back there with Ryan Hunter-Reay going to make a move to go around Ryan Hunter-Reay. They told Hunter-Reay a moment ago to save a little bit of fuel. Maybe we can get an extra lap on these guys. Sato, the 2017 winner of the Indy 500. I asked him, is the race live in Japan? He said, absolutely. And it's watched by a ton of people there. He said, I'll get texts all during the race of people texting me about how we're doing right now. Sato very happy with the car. A little too much understeer though, Kevin.
Marty, last year's Rookie of the Year, Santino Ferrucci, started back in 19th and had very little confidence until Friday when he thinks they found something that will allow him to be able to race. And early, he said, it's starting to come alive. He picked up 4 spots in the first stint. Slow pit stop, dropped it back to 25th. He gained 10 almost immediately, and now runs 7. And he's been working on Marco Andretti for quite a few laps, trying to get him, Kelly.
Kevin, if you can believe it, it's been 80 years since a native Hoosier won this race. That was Wilbur Shaw back in 1940, and now it's 28-year-old Connor Daly trying to change that today. He told me as a local kid, he practically grew up here at this speedway, idolizing the IndyCar drivers before him. Now he's among them. He said it would mean everything to him to win this race. Running 16th now, they got a little bit of work to do. He's super loose, Marty.
Kelly, you're going to see a lot of this today. Tires are important. Fresh Firestones do mean a little extra lap time. But we mentioned when you catch that lap traffic, you catch other cars, you'll want to come to pit road. That's the call Brian Herta made for Marco Andretti, putting on these 4 Fresh Firestones. He has too much understeer, Kelly.
Might be looking for the undercut here, Kelly, as he comes in a little bit earlier than everybody else. Fresh tires, sometimes king. As we see Spencer Pigot now trying to make some moves as he leaves the pits.
This is the third car in the Ray Hall Letterman Lanigan camp. It's Team RLL with Citroen Buell Autosport. Ryan Hunter-Reay saying, I lost my balance.
There you go. He was saying that as he was coming down pit road, comes in slowly to his stall. They were actually hoping to save a little bit of fuel. As you see the 7th man going over the wall there, pulling a tear off this new aero screen. Hunter-Reay saying the balance kind of went away on this run. But again, they were hoping to go a lap longer than everybody else. They come earlier than everybody else. Tony Kanaan leaving pit road as well.
Something we need to update you on this different strategy, this varying strategy, is that within the Team Penske group, Will Power was able to leapfrog not only Simon Pagenaud, but then the Arrow McLaren SP driver Oliver Askew in that group. Here's Santino Ferrucci. The Sealmaster Honda has been flying today, PT.
Yeah, you're looking at, you get a chance. Look at that back wing. You can see he's got a full wicker across the back wing, and he says, great on restarts, but when it strings out, it's a little too draggy. So something that they can maybe adjust on later in the race, Townsend, try to take a little bit of back wing out of that car if they get the opportunity.
Well, take a look at this and what just happened to Alexander Rossi as he comes to pit lane.
Oh, outside the lines. He might get a penalty for that. He missed the pit entry.
Overcooked it out of 4. It must have been a late call, perhaps, and that's going to be a huge time loss. That's a That's got to be several seconds he'll lose to Dixon.
Going for the big in lap, Marty.
And Paul, we're going to see how much that will affect him. You see Scott Dixon on pit road. Right behind him, Rinus VK trying to pull out of his stall.
VK stalls
his car. You see Rossi, he leaves pretty close to Dixon, so I'm wondering if it did not hamper him that much. But VK killed the car when he came out of pit road, just popped the clutch too quick, and it stalled on him. They had to push him back, crank it back up. But Rinus VK going to lose a massive amount of time. He came to pit road running third, guys.
That's the only blemish that this 19-year-old Dutch driver has had this month here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
He's going to come right out. 6.2-second pit stop for Dixon. Flying in the pits, flying on track. The Wicks car coming out, Dreyer and Reinbold car.
Kev, what you got?
Well, Sage Karam was stopped right in the middle of the lane. I just got down to the box to try to find out what happened, but we saw him stopped and they had to push back, so I don't know. And here we'll see a replay. So he came in too hot and he just missed the box. That's Fernando Alonso in the first stall, and then Max Chilton's back there as well. So a lot of costly track position for Karam.
Mistakes on pit lane continue. A lot of little problems going on. He doesn't race very much, Sage Karam, so he just came in, down some way too hot. As here comes Fernando Alonso for his second stop. He looks like he's leaving now.
Sticker tires on Alonso. Talked to the this morning. Alonso admitted this was going to be a very difficult day to work his way to the front.
This is actually his third stop, because he was one of that group that came in on lap 8. Then he came in again on lap 27. So in the Ruoff Mortgage Chevrolet, Alonso has been in now three times. This is Felix Rosenquist in the NTT Honda for Chip Ganassi Racing. Two of the three Ganassi cars are left in the race. Marcus Ericsson is out. Kel?
And that's Felix Rosenquist, the second Swede for Chip Ganassi Racing, making his pit stop. He said he had a little bit of understeer. You see a little adjustment there in the front ring, and he is off, Danica.
Yeah, pit stops is that point in time as a driver that there's a lot going through your head. You're trying to adjust your bars, adjust your shocks. There's a lot to think about and a lot of pressure. You know that there's football fields of length on the line if you come in a little slower, come out a little slow. So a lot going on. We saw a lot of mistakes from veterans and rookies. So it'll be interesting to see how this plays out.
Guys, two races going on at the same time here, Paul.
Yeah.
One race is the overall race that is Scott Dixon is leading. The next closest guy on the same strategy to him is Takuma Sato, who's some 7.5, I take that back. Rossi is now 4 seconds back. And then you've got the group led by Oliver Askew, who is second, who's on a totally different lap count to Scott Dixon. So we'll keep you up to date as to who is where. Here's Helio Castroneves in his 20th Indy 500 in the Pennzoil Chevrolet.
Here's the thing, with that mega stop by Dixon, Askew, Pagano, Castroneves cycled back to the front, but he beat them on the pit stop exchange and now has created a big gap to his main rival, his Rossi. So he's got a nice buffer now between him and Rossi that are on the same strategy.
That buffer about 5.6 seconds for Dixon to Rossi. So to your point, Paul, very costly mistake there on the pit entry attempt and the wave off, and Rossi had to get everything back up to speed as Dixon now catching up to the back of Alonso.
Okay, to sit here. Yes.
Gonna sit here and save fuel. Alonso's got fresh tires, so he might be fast enough, but here comes the rest of the pack.
Paul, that's the other thing for Scott Dixon. Now this puts him at a massive advantage. He can just kind of manage his fuel this entire run, and really, even more than the five-second gap he gained when Rossi missed pit road, by saving fuel here, he can really try and put everybody else out of the game to win the 500.
And look, Rossi's going to try and get past this group that is fast. They're on a different strategy. That's rookie Oliver Askew in the Arrow McLaren SP Chevrolet making the move on the inside of fellow rookie Dalton Kellett.
He's got to realize that these guys, Townsend, are going to pit, so you don't want to get too crazy because they're not on your sequence, but he certainly can't afford to lose too much ground to Dixon.
Watch this, Townsend. Rinus VK, we believe he's going to be assessed a penalty for contact with one of his crew members.
Boy. Yeah, he did have contact with a few crew members.
Locked the left front, coming into his box, too hot. And too bad for VK, had such a great day going, but this will really set him back.
That's going to be a stop and go for hitting team personnel. Talking about going, Takuma Sato's going well, but none better today than Scott Dixon.
The diehard batteries you know and trust are now in Advance. Unrivaled performance meets unrivaled expertise. Diehard batteries, now at Advanced Auto Parts.
Scott Dixon in the PNC Bank Honda for Chip Ganassi Racing in his 18th Indy 500 has led for 52 laps and is well and truly in control at the moment. Closest driver to him on the same strategy as Alexander Rossi is now Takuma Sato. Sato's got by Rossi is 10 seconds. Those closest to him, as you see on the progressive leaderboard there, Oliver Askew, Simon Pagenaud, Elio Castroneves, they're on different strategies. So how will this play out as we inch closer to the halfway of the 104th running of the Indianapolis 500?
Well, still so much and so long to play out. 125 laps to go, but right now Scott Dixon absolutely in control, using Fernando Alonso there in front. Alonso's the last car on the lead lap, and he's just serving as a lead blocker, blocking the wind for Dixon, allowing him to get great fuel mileage and just increase his advantage at this point.
Yeah, the pace isn't particularly quick for Dixon, but they are pulling away from that secondary pack back there. But right now, he is a step ahead in this chess match to everybody else.
Paul running fourth right now is Elio Castroneves. Over a decade, he's been seeking win number four, and this could be the last chance for him. The sports car deal is over. He's a free agent. It's not been ruled out to return to Team Penske, but yeah, the best way to return would be to win. And he said, I got a chance. But what he told me this morning is, being back here again over the last week plus, this is where I want to be. IndyCar is my home, and he's hoping to run full time. Pit stops coming for Castroneves and Pagenaud.
Pagenaud gave the signal. Now they're about to peel off. Coming around turn four. We'll see if they both come together.
I saw Castroneves' boys laid out, so this will be Team Penske versus Team Penske versus, I think, Will Power Team Penske. Great battle on pit lane.
Will Power locks it up again on the entry.
And Oliver Askew stays out amongst that group. He gets a little better fuel mileage and got past the Penskes. Pagenaud is in the brighter yellow Menards car, and then the Pennzoil yellow is right behind. They leave at the same time, and Pagenaud will win that race. Kelly.
Another Team Penske car on pit road. That's Willpower. He's just finished. No changes for the 12 as he slides in between his two teammates.
They all pitted a lap apart last time, all together now. Pagenaud, Power, and Elio Castroneves.
That's like flying in sequence, like the Air Force that flew over the track in the pre-race.
The Thunderbirds appearing at the Indianapolis 500 for the first time, because usually on Memorial Day in May, they've got other commitments in other parts of the country, so it was terrific to have the Thunderbirds here. It's Charlie Kimball for AJ Foyt Racing, Kev.
And he cycled up to fifth. It's been a challenge for them, but he said, I think we finally got it figured out. Front wing adjustment here for Charlie Kimball. His dad, Gordon, who helped design Indy cars and Formula One cars, one of the few times he's never been at one of Charlie's races, almost always there, he's watching from home in California.
But Supertex is here. AJ Foyt in his 65th. Indianapolis 500. There's race leader Scott Dixon working on the back of the Ruoff Mortgage, the progressive Chevrolet for Fernando Alonso, Arrow McLaren SP. Spent some time with Fernando yesterday. Asked him about his move back to Formula One. He's got a two-year contract with Renault. And I said, do you feel like you've got unfinished business? And he said, no, not at all. He said, I'm still as passionate as ever, but I want to enjoy this. They will be my last 2 years in Formula One, and I want to go and have some fun. He said, don't get me wrong, I'm still as determined as ever, but I don't feel like there are unchecked things. I'm going to go back, I'm going to enjoy it, I'm going to race as hard as I always have, but I'm going to really, really soak it up and make the most of it and enjoy it.
And I'm sure he's enjoying a little bit of clean air, but it's not great for fuel mileage for Alonso. Again, last car on the lead lap, so he's going to need a break here, either a yellow or something else to help get him to the front, as Oliver Sorry, Askew comes in the pit lane. Let's watch this one.
And what a story he's been so far. He's passed Simon Pagenaud. Will Power on track. He made a last-second pass to win the Freedom 100 last year. There's the tear-off to clean off that aero screen that they pull off on pit lane. Askew is back out.
First Indianapolis 500 with the aero screen. You notice the extra pit crew member gets over there and pulls the tear-off to keep that windshield, that aero screen clear. There is the Salesforce Chevrolet, the Dreyer and Reinbold entry for J.R. Hildebrand. Got a really interesting helmet design for this year's 500. Very motivational quotes, words, statements to try and kind of spark a thought and get us all to act a little bit better in 2020 and the years beyond.
There you see the battle, Lee, of the alt strategy. Pagenaud, Power, Castroneves around Oliver Askew on the pit stop cycle.
A little bit of a slow stop for Askew compared to the Penske's. The Penske's all did phenomenal stops. They had a small issue on the inside front, but he slots back out. But right now, Dixon has a 10-second lead over Sato. Rossi, 11 seconds. Andretti right behind Rossi now. And Ferrucci has moved up into fifth.
60 laps out in front. That sounds pretty good to Chip Ganassi, and his longest tenured driver, Scott Dixon of New Zealand, continues to lead the way. Third caution of the day flies here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway for 26-year-old Canadian and rookie at the 500, Dalton Kellett for AJ Foyt Racing.
He's done a nice job this month. You know, people said he was maybe a little over his head for this, and Townsend, he's really been consistent, had nice pace, qualified well, but here we get a replay. He goes on the inside and just kind of stuffs it in there and then gets the wake wash and runs it up into the gray and bangs the wall. So
he had a run going on Ben Hanley, and I think he thought Hanley would give him the corner, and then he washed up into the dirty air. Very similar to the Marcus Ericsson impact at the other end of the track as we ride on board with Rossi. Up ahead, you see Hanley come across the nose of Kellett.
And low, go low, go low, go low.
Got to be so
good
careful.
Job,
that's
job.
Almost an identical accident that Scott Dixon had a couple years ago when the car hit the wall like that, and then it came down across in front of him, and pretty good damage to Dalton's car. But now we're under yellow. This is going to change up, Marty. The whole strategy game is going to get tossed upside down again.
Yeah, Paul, that was a good break for everybody in the field except Scott Dixon. Comfortably out there with that 10-second lead of Arsato and honestly saving fuel at that point. Dixon did not need this caution, but everybody else certainly did. Takuma Sato and Alexander Rossi as well. They run 1-2-3. Pits will open in theory next time by, but Dixon did not want to see this caution.
On board the Auto Nation Napa Auto Parts Honda there with Alexander Rossi, who's also has a special Indianapolis 500 helmet dedicated to first responders. Look at that in the center of your screen. A big thank you to everybody on the front line during this COVID-19 pandemic. A really nice gesture from Alexander and his team. So he sits third, his teammate Marco Andretti fourth, Santino Ferrucci, last year's Rookie of the Year in the 500, fifth, Hunter Ray, another Andretti car in sixth. Lead rookie is Pato O'Ward in seventh, and then James Hinchcliffe, Colton Herter, and the first Penske car, and only the second Chevrolet in the top 10, Joseph Newgarden, in 10th. AMR safety team, again, on the spot, nice and quick to aid the AJ Foyt car of Dalton Kellett. Now, with the unprecedented speed and bandwidth of Verizon 5G Ultra Wideband, a 5G connected camera, there it is right there, is capturing unique angles of all the excitement surrounding the Indy 500. And again, there's no cables as far as that. It's a 5G connected camera. So pretty cool, pushing the technology parameters to make the sport we love so much better. Hi. That's not what Dalton Kellett wanted to see. His K-Line Insulators Chevrolet going back on the flatbed to join Marcus Ericsson and James Davison as the retirees, just the three retirees from this year's race.
Should be interesting with the tow truck. Whoa. Some going low. Dixon goes low to pit lane.
That's
others
not,
stay out.
Not optimal there, but he got a big gap there to everybody
People are staying out, but look at the gap to Sato. So
tow truck was like a pick there.
Yeah, I know.
Look at that lead Dixon has. Marty, let's find out what Scott Dixon has, if those guys can be 6 seconds again.
Yeah, some of these guys kind of staying out here, so a little reversal of strategy. But Takuma Sato, kind of a sigh of relief in the 30 camp. He said, undo that last wing change. Did not like that. They're going to change with air pressure. He's dealing with understeer once he hits traffic. Alexander Rossi, you talk about a sigh of relief. The man who missed pit road earlier, he gets to close up that five-second gap. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment. Dixon easily wins the race off pit road, even though there was a long debate about whether or not they wanted to come down pit road. Everybody up front comes down pit road.
Trouble for Marco Andretti with the right rear. He loses two spots. Look at Newgarden. T. Penske getting five positions to last year's champion on the pit stop. Well done.
Tell you what, Marco Andretti pulled in right in front of Dixon, and that could create trouble for him to get out later on in the race.
Good work from Pato O'Ward and the Arrow McLaren SP team as well. They got the young rookie. There he is. They got him up three spots.
The definition of a partly cloudy day, half of the 2.5 mile oval surrounded by clouds, sunshine on the rest. It is lap 90 of 200. We're approaching halfway. Three cautions, three cars out so far. Danica Patrick, a lot of the conversation about strategy, and we'll get to all the nitty gritty here in a little bit. For the driver, can you get involved in the thoughts of the strategy, or do you just have to believe in the engineers and your team and block all that out and just do what you're doing?
As a driver, you're sitting in the car and you're really at the mercy of what they're telling you is going on, especially during green. Now, under yellow, you start to get a real feel for where you stack up, so you can get a little frustrated at times. But when you're on track under green, you're kind of lost. You really need your team to tell you where you're at. And your job as a driver is to very much just drive that strategy.
So how's Scott Dixon feeling right now? Because as the guy said, he's the one for whom that yellow was a bad break.
Right.
Still, he's looked like he's been as good a car as any, if not the clear best, thus far through 90 laps.
Right. Well, yes, he lost that 10-second lead that he so, you know, valiantly got. But he is still leading the leader's strategy. So like I said before the race started, is that there's the leader's strategy and then there's off strategy, and they both have a great chance of winning. I also said that Penske also likes to divide and make sure that they can conquer. And so we've got Penske's on both sides of that, but Dixon's leading, Rosenquist is leading. And so we'll see how this plays out.
Well, here comes more strategy changes. Late pit stops, let's go down and watch this set. Kevin's down there.
Mike, a lot of these that pitted on 76 came in, including Simon Pagenaud, because they would have needed four stops if it stayed green. Now they can get home on three the rest of the way, Kelly.
And for his teammate Will Power, he's been talking about kind of a pushy, loose feeling, the team telling him to soften the front bar, but they've made no changes on pit road, just some Firestone tires and Speedway fuel.
And he beats his two teammates out. How did you like the rookie Oliver Askew trying to wedge his way in between Elio Castroneves and Pagenaud? Yeah. And Elio said, I don't think so, young man.
Well, VK has wedged himself in between those Penske teammates, but Townsend, this really kind of puts everybody back on the same strategy.
Oh, within, it does.
Within a couple of laps now, so
yeah.
Everything is kind of like back to square one at literally half distance.
Yes, advantage Dixon, really. Yes, he lost the gap to Sato, but he doesn't end up unlucky on strategy there. So we'll see what happens on this restart, because Sato was looking also awfully racy along with Alexander Rossi on some of those restarts.
Let's go to Rutledge Wood.
Lee, we've got a chance for fans to be a part of this historic 104th running using the hashtag message in a milk bottle. All the drivers filled out some stuff. We're getting some great tweets that are rolling in. Fans, we love you. We know we wish you were here with us. But make sure you get yours in just like Marie McIntosh did. She's enjoying watching it. A totally different view in the driveway this year in the backyard. But also, so did Charlie South Jr. He sent one in too. Everybody's trying to have as much fun as they can. It's a different IMS. But like we heard Doug Bowles say earlier, if you're watching, it counts for being here. Guys, it is getting so intense.
First Indianapolis 500 with the new ownership after 75 years in the hands of the Holman George family. It is now Roger Penske and his organization owning the Indianapolis Motor Speedway and also the NTT IndyCar Series. So we're in good hands with the captain. This is what happened to the Genesis Honda of James Hinchcliffe, or what didn't happen.
Looks like the car stalled, perhaps, or maybe he wasn't able to get it in gear. It's tough to tell if the engine is still running there.
Yeah, he didn't even try to launch, so
something odd for you. Maybe it went into anti-stall mode and just wouldn't rev up, but we're coming to the restart, Lee. Let's rock and roll, baby.
Yeah, and we've now got two Chevrolets in the top five. They're trying to take the fight back to the Hondas, but it's Scott Dixon for Chip Ganassi Racing that will see the green flag first. Let's go. Takuma Sato is not too far behind, and Alexander Rossi as well. And
oh!
Pick up the rookie. There's a spinner.
Connor Daly spins it.
Big hit
for Dixon.
Oliver Askew
lost it in the smoke, and that was a massive hit.
That was nasty.
So it was panic in the back when Connor Daly lit it up and lost it. And then you can't, I would imagine, Townsend, that the smoke, he probably couldn't see.
Well, but he was so fast onto the scene. I'm not sure if Connor Daly was hit or what happened. As the AMR team quick to tend to ask you, get the fire out on the right rear.
That was a big hit.
Wow, that was a vicious angle, too, that he came darting off of turn four.
Not to bring up bad subjects, Danica, but you've had accidents where you just go straight towards the wall. I've actually never had one, and you're just a passenger. You're like, oh, my God, this is going to be a big one.
So that's Connor Daly in the US Air Force Chevrolet for Ed Carpenter Racing. Connor is talking to the AMR safety team. And they will, they'll help him out of that car in just a moment.
Danica, what's it like when you have no control of your car? Like you've had it happen at Daytona where you're going at an angle and you can't stop, but you're just looking at the wall going, oh, my God, here we go.
Well, I think you saw the NASCAR drivers started doing what I was doing in those wrecks that I learned from an IndyCar, which was to let go of the steering wheel. Once you've lost it and there's no getting it back, you just let go, because in an IndyCar, your thumbs can break and get caught in the steering wheel. So I started doing that in stock cars, and it's funny, I've seen some more of that ever since then.
Connor Daly is out of his Ed Carpenter Racing Chevrolet, his seventh Indy 500. Coming to a very premature end. This is Oliver Askew trying to get himself out of that Arrow McLaren SP Chevy, the youngster who had done so well in this race.
For sure, he hit the wall really hard, so he's shaken up a little bit there, but he's out.
And thinking about a very scary moment that he had coming off of four. The gloves come off, and it looks like
there's a lot of, I mean, you get the wind knocked right out of you when you hit that hard. Just needs a minute here to get his bearings around him.
Might have smacked his knees together. That's one of the things that'll get you in an Indy car is an impact like that. You get the inside of both knees effectively clapped together at a ferocious rate.
This is the Indy Lights champion of a year ago, the 23-year-old from Florida. He's been on the podium in his rookie season. He's a very nice young man who's got a big future ahead of him. That was the speed at which he darted across.
So here we go. Connor just loses it on the power. He's down way low. Lots of smoke. He's got the throttle wide open. And in the back here, I don't know if he got touched, but bam, side slap, pancake the wall.
Thank goodness for the safer barrier. Thank goodness for the safer barrier.
I wonder if Connor got his left front onto that apron that caught out Alonso in practice.
Yeah, I think it might, Townsend, it was maybe just trying to get squared up to get a run on that concrete. You got a great view right here if he touched that concrete. Yeah, he's on the concrete.
Yep.
So on the concrete, it jacks weight in the car and you're full power, and he loses it, keeps the throttle buried. But it'll be interesting to see if we can get an angle if Askew got turned by somebody because of the way the trajectory was where he went towards the inside.
The view from Zach Veach and the Gainbridge on board.
There goes Connor. Veach to the high side, but we still don't really see what happened with Askew.
Askew was fast arriving on the scene behind Elio Castroneves and Simon Pagenaud. Look down to the bottom left. He just took evasive action.
Yeah, he just got caught in the smoke and didn't know where the car was. You couldn't see it. I couldn't see it even with the camera, the high angle, and he just was trying to avoid it. And
just had a big oversteer moment there.
So so confronting. But again, Oliver Askew is out of his car, so too Connor Daly. Bottom left is where you'll see Askew take evasive action.
One of the things that can happen on these restarts that you don't see so easily is that sometimes you can check up, and if the car's a little light anyway, you're already not at speed with the right downforce, so all of a sudden the car gets even lighter as you lift, and bad things happen.
We had an onboard with Oliver Askew, and hopefully caught the moment to try to get a better read of what happened. Here we go.
You're all clear. Spin out front, spin out front, stay high, high, high.
I was on the brakes, Paul.
Yeah, he just couldn't, you couldn't see Connor's car, and everybody was checking up in front of him. It was option A was to run into the back of the cars in front of him or avoid, and it just hooked on him on the brakes.
One of the challenges is that you run a lot of rear brake bias here so that you don't lock up front tires coming to pit lane and coming into your box, like we saw earlier with Oliver Askew. So the flip side is all that rear brake bias can catch you out in a moment like that because you're normally never using the brakes at race pace. A really frightening moment, but again, repeating, Con Daly, Oliver Askew out of their respective race cars, brings out the fourth caution of the day. We welcome you back to NBC Sports coverage of the 104th Indianapolis 500, presented by Gainbridge. Lee Diffie, Townsend Bell, Paul Tracy with you on the call, Danica Patrick and Mike Tirico, and working pit road, Kelly Stavis, Kevin Lee, and Marty Snyder. What you got, Marty?
Hey, Lee, one of the interesting things about doing the Indy 500 here in August on an almost a 90-degree day here in Indianapolis is that the pit box here on pit road for Alexander Rossi and his team has actually overheated twice. They've had to shut it down, recycle it, and when they do that, they lose communication with Alexander. You see them trying to do everything they can to keep it cool inside. And Rob Edwards told me that's certainly one of the aspects of why we missed pit road earlier on. He said we made a very late call for Alexander to come to pit road. We didn't tell him until he was in turn four to come to pit road. That was on us, not on Alexander. No way he could have slowed down to make it to pit road. So a warm afternoon here in Indianapolis, and certainly having an effect not only on the drivers in the car, but also here on pit road as well. Under caution, Scott Dixon still leading here in the Indy 500.
One lap away from the midpoint of the Indianapolis 500 under yellow. Connor Daly, the first to spin under this caution. Connor, what happened?
Man, I'm not entirely sure. Like, I had a good run, and we're still going slow. It's like my left front tire fell into a hole or something. So I'm just not really sure why that happened. That's never happened before. So just very strange. Hate it, obviously. I thought I almost had it, and then obviously Oliver. I don't know what happened to him. That was a shame to see for him too. Obviously it's a shame the U.S. Air Force. You know, we had such a great presence here. It looks like I just caught the curb, which is probably on me. So it's a shame. We're just looking forward to Gateway now. Super thankful to be here with the U.S. Air Force. They're the most incredible partner that I've had. And I hate it for them. It's probably my mistake. So it's a shame.
Thanks, Connor.
Good to see that he is okay out of the car, and a shame that he is out of this 104th running. Look how things are tight now. Dixon, Scott Dixon, race leader in that PNC Bank Honda. He has got Takuma Sato all over him. Alexander Rossi, then Pato O'Ward, the 21-year-old rookie. Let's go again.
Sato made a good restart there, but I don't think he's close enough to draft up. But now Rossi has the draft, the double draft here. Might have an opportunity to go to the inside, which is his favorite spot, Townsend.
Got it done. Alexander Rossi threw on the inside of Sato and sets out after Dixon.
Santino Ferrucci with a big run goes for the short shoot move on Newgarden. That is bold and high risk, but Ferrucci pulls it off.
That's Seal Master. Honda has been flying today, PT.
Ferrucci's got that little bit higher downforce setup. He's great on the restarts, but he needs to get it trimmed out if he's going to have a shot at running up front. But right now, the dogfight is going to be Dixon Rossi.
This is Ferrucci on Takuma Sato. Wow. That thing has been moving. That dust you see flying is the oil dry from the AMR safety team as they come on up. Newgarden has seen Marco Andretti go by. This is Ryan Hunter-Reay, Tony Kanaan, and Colton Herta through turn one.
Colton Herta gets a little bit in the aero wash there. Tony Kanaan doing a great job moving his way forward up inside, just inside the top 10.
Take you back a moment ago, riding aboard the Napa Auto Parts Honda, Alexander Rossi. That's how you do it inside into turn one.
These passes coming awfully late at the end of the long straightaway. Watch Ferrucci now. He checks up. Actually, he doesn't check up. He goes high, has a big run, and Newgarden checked up. Ferrucci goes to the inside in that short shoot. Now Rossi takes the lead.
Here's the fight that we're going to have. I believe this is going to be the fight for the win.
I think Scott Dixon might have just given Rossi the lead. Marty, do you think Dixon's trying to save fuel right now?
That's exactly right, Townsend. It's the game of who wants to lead right now. They told Alexander Rossi, all of these teams, by the way, are so close on making it on two stops. They told Alexander Rossi, we cannot make it on two stops. We need a little bit of help. And I asked Chris Simmons, one of the engineers for Scott Dixon a moment ago, I said, can you make it on two stops? He said, yes, but not leading. So Dixon gave up the lead intentionally to save some fuel here. Rossi knows he can't make it on two stops, but it's so tempting to get the lead for the Indy 500.
Look who is in third place. It's the rookie, Pato O'Ward, in the Arrow McLaren SP Chevrolet. This kid was quickest on Carb Day on Friday. He was denied his first career win at Road America earlier this year. He is driven by passion. He wants to be an IndyCar race winner, and he told me last night, I can win this Indy 500.
So close to winning his first race at Road America, and he's right up front here. His team principal, Zach Brown, flew over from England. He's got the whole support, and we've got his teammate now out of the hospital unit, Oliver Askew.
And Paul, he was super fast as well. First of all, Oliver, we're so happy to see you walk over to us. You got out very gingerly. How are you?
Yeah, I'm okay now. I was a little shaken up after that hit. I think I got the wind knocked out of me and banged up my knee a little bit. But I do want to say thank you to Dallara and IndyCar for making these cars so safe, and the AMR safety crew as well. So yeah, a little shaken up by that, but yeah, big sorry to the team. We're having a good run there, being very aggressive on strategy, and the car felt really good. So yeah, in the accident there, I saw a bunch of smoke in front of me, and I think I tried to avoid Elio and just lost the car trying to avoid the accident. So yeah, it's a shame.
One thing we all knew, Oliver Askew was here today. He led laps and ran up front much of the time.
Speaking of running up front, Kevin Scott Dixon now gets back into the lead. Now, is it a game of kind of chess here? Yeah. Is Rossi letting him get that lead back? We'll see.
It'll be a bit of a chess match, Townsend, but I think that Dixon saw Pato closing up and said, okay, I'm just going to jump back to the front here, and maybe they can break away from this little group
here. Last lap for Rossi, 2:11. Nobody wants to lead right now. This is all about the cat and mouse of fuel mileage.
It's going to be an absolute chess match, Paul. And they told a moment ago, they said, hey, I'm going to let you drive. Rod Edwards told Alexander Rossi, who goes back to the lead, little hopscotch going on here. He said, I'm going to let you drive it. You do what you want to do right now. Just know, if you're leading, we can't make it to the end on fuel. They told Scott Dixon the same thing. So it's sort of swapping the lead, playing nice between Honda corporate teammates here. We'll see what happens.
If they can play this correctly, Townsend, you know, if you fly in formation, you can just time everything right and protect the gap second to third.
Well, these two guys know that if they do the leapfrog, they will get better mileage.
I think we want to get the pack too tight. So if Rossi could work with us, let's try and string it out.
Exactly what I said. They don't want the pack too tight. They don't want Pato right there to be able to make a move to get by both of them. So they need to just time everything in formation and try to break away from the pack.
Andretti Autosport leads Chip Ganassi Racing, leads Arrow McLaren SP, leads Ray Hall Letterman Lanigan, leads Dale Coyne Racing with Vasser Sullivan. Here is that very distinctive Sealmaster Honda of Santino Ferrucci. Keep in mind the speeds that they're running now, just to play this very clever strategy. They're running 215, 216 mile an hour laps. Fastest lap of the race belongs to James Hinchcliffe at 223 miles an hour. So significantly off that high pace, just to make sure they can get those fuel numbers. Here's Dixon again.
Three vets up front, two rookies. So it's going to be a battle of Townsend of youth and experience, and the guys that are young are super aggressive.
Hey,
Hey, Paul and Townsend, so how willing are you, if you're Scott Dixon or Alexander Rossi, to play this game? That's the guy you got to beat for the Indy 500. How willing are you to play this game, and for how long do you play it?
Perfectly willing to play the game as long as it gets us to the end of the race. We can sort it out on the last stint. Right now, it's about making the mileage, holding position, and we'll sort it out with 10 to go.
And it certainly gives you an opportunity to really examine where each guy's car is strong, not strong, because it always comes down to one car's better at one end of the track, the other one's better at the other end of the track, and it's you just start figuring it all out.
Let's take you back a few moments ago to the restart, and it's with the defending Indianapolis 500 race winner, Simon Pagenaud, the Menards Chevy. That's Felix Rosenquist to the left.
Three wide down the front straightaway here. Big log jam in front of him.
Hinchcliffe inside. And Piggott on the inside, and Pagenaud decides to tuck back in, but he can't because Rosenquist is there, and around goes Will Power, his teammate. Oh boy.
Some bold, bold moves. Paul, I was just thinking to myself that with Rossi and Dixon swapping lead here, it actually helps all those cars behind. Guys like Sato, Ferrucci, Ray Hall, and Marco Andretti. They're getting better mileage than the leaders. Yeah, so that could factor
Rob Edwards.
The race.
Rob Edwards, Rossi strategist, said on the radio, keep doing this. We need to build the gap on Pato. But Pato's hanging tough right there. The gap right now is really to Sato. So this Pato just needs to sit here.
Everybody in line.
He needs to sit here and just watch this and learn, because he might have an opportunity at the end of the race when these guys start to fight. He might be able to get both of them.
This is a young guy who won the Indy Lights Championship 2 years ago, stepped up to IndyCar last year, did the first seven events of the season, and he got the eye, he caught the eye of Red Bull and Dr. Helmut Marko. He got whisked off to Europe, he did a couple of F2 races, then they sent him to Japan, and he did the remainder of the season there. Then he came back, so it was kind of a whirlwind last year. He tried to qualify for this race, had a huge crash, didn't make the field for Carlin Racing. And here he is, new team, full-time now in the NTT IndyCar Series with Arrow McLaren SP, and he is ready.
He's a rookie. Sit, watch, and learn these two guys that have won the Indy 500, and you have a shot at winning.
Today's wonderful aerial coverage is brought to you by Guaranteed Rate, and that aerial coverage shows you the first and second place cars of Scott Dixon, Alexander Rossi, who, Marty, they continue to swap that lead position. Why don't you take us through the field with thanks to Honda?
And let's talk about this little duel going on between Scott Dixon and Alexander Rossi. They've even gotten it down pat to where their spotters, who are standing in the grandstands in turn one, are standing together and decide when they're going to swap the lead. So they're going to have to go about 15 more laps here. But if you'll notice behind them, Takuma Sato has caught this group, everyone right now, trying to save fuel, trying to make it on two more stops. They told Alexander Rossi on the radio, you know what? We're going to let you have fun at the end of this race. I promise, Kevin.
Pato Award running in fourth. Remember, he's a rookie, and if he wins the race, the 21-year-old would still become the youngest Indianapolis 500 winner ever. Troy Ruttman was 22 in 1952. Carr came alive towards the end of the week. They've got a chance. Right behind him, Santino Ferrucci started back in 19th. They are not thinking about trimming. They are going to keep it fairly high downforce because he likes the car. It's been discussed, and he's also trying to make it on two more stops. Marty.
Kevin, look who's up in the sixth position, Graham Rahal, who told me earlier this week, if I'm going to win this race, I've got to find a little something extra in me. Everybody thinks I'm the most aggressive guy in the field, but for some reason, this track has always had my number. I just want to be in position at the end of the race. Here we are with 83 to go, and he sits in sixth. Meanwhile, Marco Andretti is in seventh after starting on the pole today. Wound up not leading a lap so far, but they went with that full downforce setting, and Marco's been doing a very nice job. This is about the furthest down he's been in seventh. Very solid afternoon, Kelly.
Joseph Newgarden told me he was about as confident in his car coming into this race as he ever has been heading into the Indy 500. He told me he's got to be in the top three by the time they make their last pit stop if he's going to have a shot at winning this race. Well, his pit crew got him into the top five, gaining five spots. He has since slid back to eighth, but he says he is better at the end of the run. He's just struggling to keep that right rear happy, Marty.
Kelly rookie Alex Palou sitting in the ninth position, and the Spaniard was mad at the Spanish media earlier this week. Why? Because all the headlines in Spain were about Fernando Alonso, who he easily outqualified. He said, well, I guess if I have two world championships, they would talk about me. I know I've got some ground to gain, but right now sitting in the ninth spot. Colton Herta having a solid second half of this race, sitting in 10th. He's been talking about too much understeer, and he reminded me yesterday, he said, hey, to me, this is my first Indy 500. Last year, we only lasted three laps, so I've got to kind of learn how this race goes. His teammate, Ryan Hunter-Reay, sits in 11th. They have been struggling since that first run where they were so good, they just have not had the handling on this 28 car. Since that moment, Hunter-Reay has been struggling with understeer. The 2014 Indy 500 winner trying to crack the top 10, Kelly.
Tony Kanaan told me that he feels like he's got one of the best race cars he's had here in the last several years. Feels really good in traffic, just struggling to get past those Hondas. This was supposed to be TK's last lap, but he said to not have fans here, especially for the Indy 500, just doesn't do it justice. He had big plans for the month of May to spend a lot of time with race fans. So all he needs now, he said, is a team, a car, and a sponsor, but he plans to be back here again next year.
And that makes sense because Tony's still in just the greatest shape of his life, and he's constantly the most popular driver in IndyCar, so why wouldn't you come back, Townsend?
His buddy, Alonso, I got to give an update on him. He's got himself back on the lead lap now and has moved up into 17th, just behind our colleague, Townsend, James Hinchcliffe.
Alonso doing a great job. You've got to stay in it. Stay focused, stay hungry. His caution's out.
What's it for? Where is it? Oh, there it is.
Oh,
it's Alex Palou, the rookie, who had such a glittering time here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Qualifying in the Fast 9 shootout, looked great in practice, looked great every session. How has his race ended? What caused it? The driver of the Dale Coyne Racing with Team Go Honda.
He's right over here by turn two, so he's had the accident in one, hit it one, and is about 200 yards up the road from me. The car's pointed backwards.
Similar position to end up, Paul, from the accident earlier in turn one. Palou climbs out. I talked to him this morning. He was so happy to have his family here from Spain, his girlfriend, his mom and dad, his sister. Felt so confident, so excited.
He has dreamed of racing in the United States for many, many years, hence the special helmet with the stars and stripes. This is how it
He's
ended
high.
For Alex Palou.
High already, and just
Erickson's
got up out of the gray.
Exactly.
Tried to get it stopped. He got on the brakes and then kind of just skidded along the short chute wall right there. And I'm over there in the turn two suite. He stopped just short, but just got up high, and then he realized, Townsend, he was going to hit the wall and jammed the brakes on to try to stop, and it was locked up when he hit the wall.
That's an understandable reaction when your wall's coming at you that fast. It looked so similar to Marcus Ericsson's crash where he went out. That was lap 24.
So James Davison was the first out of this race with a really odd right front brake rotor problem where it just exploded and was on fire. Marcus Ericsson with a very similar crash to this for Chip Ganassi Racing. He exited. Dalton Kellett also with contact with the wall. And then Connor Daly and Oliver Askew also crashing out of this year's Indy 500.
Guys, this is short of where they needed to get to do two stops. So right now, if they all pit, you're probably looking, depending on how long this yellow takes, Townsend and Marty, you're still looking at a splash at the end because they needed to go quite a bit further than this.
Yeah, this is certainly short of where they were planning to pit, Paul, if it stayed green. But I think with the Firestones and how much they are worth, everybody's going to come down pit road here and get four fresh tire Firestones on. Otherwise, it would be a bad move not to pit here.
Well, if you're at the back, you might want to get out front and just lead some. You know, these guys at Castro Neves are stuck back there in 20th. You know, you got some laps still to go. You might want to cycle yourself to the front and see if you can just put it up front there for a little bit just for some glory.
Yeah, but boy, you lose a lot of time having to pit under green.
Here's the Ruoff Chevrolet of Fernando Alonso, two-time Formula One world champion. Could this be his last Indy 500? Renault have already said they're not going to allow him to come back and do this race in the next 2 years. That puts Fernando in his early 40s. there's drivers in this race that are older than that, but well, no, who knows? We will see. Danica?
Yeah, this is obviously turning into a bit of a fuel strategy race. You know, we were talking about having so many strategies going on to the point where I'm asking you guys how many strategies are there, and now we're down to one, and now we're down to really it being a fuel strategy race perhaps. But I'm kind of curious to see if when we go green, if it's really, really pushing it and you'd have to go really slow, I wonder if we're going to see someone blitz it. I wonder if we're going to see someone just going for it and going for broke on there being a yellow at just the right time. That could be interesting.
Yeah, I think if I'm Pagano, Alonso, Hinchcliffe, I think I might stay out here and just, you know, get up front and then hope that there's another yellow, because these guys get super racy in the back, and it's going to be this pit stop. It's going to be a packed pit stop, Marty.
I think he's the answer. I think we've got the answer as to who's thinking what, because look at it. Everybody's coming, Marty.
How about everybody being the answer, Lee? Yeah, they're all coming down pit road. Takuma Sato saying, I need a half turn of wing out on that run. And interestingly, Scott Dixon on the bottom of your screen said it was almost hard to tell what the car was doing because we weren't really running at the pace that I would have liked. But everybody asking for tear-offs here. And again, this will not get them in the window to make it on one more stop with 76 laps to go. We're going to see who wins the race off of pit road here. Tight for Dixon to get around Marco Andretti. But Pato O'Ward picks up a spot here.
Let's see what happened there with Alexander. And it's very difficult to see in IndyCars anyway. Add this new aero screen. Let's have a look at the Napa Auto Parts Honda here. And look in the background. Here comes Sato. Sato's launched.
Half a turn of front wing. Ooh. And it's, you know, it's going to be a tough call. Unsafe release. He tries to stay inside the slow lane, but three cars all going for one spot, really, Townsend.
Yeah, but Sato was behind O'Ward, meaning he's not going to beat him. They're both on the same pit speed limiter. So generally what you're looking for is the inside car to back off and tuck up behind O'Ward and get out of the slow lane. So I don't know that that's a deserved penalty. As Ferrucci and Colton Herta have, there's another example. You know, right there, there's no benefit for Colton Herta. It's the timeline. It's not a race. It is a race, but it's totally dictated digitally by the transponder. So there's no benefit to pushing the limit. And let's check in on the status of Alex Palou with Kelly Stavast.
Townsend, he has assured me he's okay now that he's been released from the infield care center. Such a good run going inside the top 10. Looked like you just got a little high. What did you feel behind the cockpit?
Yeah, such a big shame. Car was awesome. I think we were gaining spots. I was gaining confidence, and the car balance was going better and better. I was just timing to get the run to Joseph. I think we had more pace than him, and yeah, just a shame for the team, for the sponsors, for everybody that is supporting us, because we could have gone really good at the end of the race. So, yeah, sorry, boys.
You got half the race, though, win. What will you take away from this first experience of the 500?
It's awesome. It's awesome, to be honest. I had lots of fun. I learned a lot. At the beginning, my timing was not really good, and then I started gaining confidence on how to get runs, and I could get some runs. I had lots of fun, and, yeah, I'm sad now, but maybe in 1 hour I'll be better.
Pillow certainly will be a fun rookie to watch moving forward.
Kelly, he's 23 years old. He won last year in the Japanese Super Formula Series, which is incredibly difficult. He's come here to IndyCar this year, and he's been on the podium already. I think Alex Palou is a name we're going to be saying for many years to come. So too is Felix Rosenquist there, the head of the field in the NTT Data Honda. He is the teammate to Scott Dixon. However, Rosenquist pitted a long time ago, so he decided just to stay out, and so too did Rinus VK. This is ostensibly the legit leader here, Scott Dixon.
Yeah, I was wondering if they were going to work together, but they've got some lapped cars, Townsend, in between them, so Dixon's got to get by these guys if he's going to work on mileage with his teammate. But right now, split strategy for Ganassi, so they can go either way on this.
We'll get back to that with Townsend in a moment, Paul, but here's Rutledge Woodruff.
Lee, you know, Roger Penske and the IMS team made so many improvements for the fans to come back here this year, and one of the greatest, besides the 30 video boards of 5,000 gallons of paint, is this new lift for Winner's Circle. That's right. They wanted everybody in the stands to be able to see the winner's car brought up, like one giant hand holding it up in front of everyone. We've got Homestead Dairy here from Indiana close by. There's so many things that fans are going to get to see when they come back here differently. But this new lift in Winner's Circle is definitely one that takes the cake, guys.
Can't wait to see whichever car it is. And boy, there has been a penalty assessed to the 27 Napa Auto Parts Honda of Alexander Rossi. Go to the back of the field.
You think he was angry last year's Indy 500. He's going to be furious as we get a replay of what happened in the pit lane, and they're calling it an unsafe release. And he drops the car, and the team tells him to go. He doesn't know. He just knows he's clear. Makes contact with Sato on the way out, and the chief steward has ruled this an unsafe release, and he goes to the back of the field.
Happens every year here, just not much room on pit lane in Indy. And Paul, to your point, we talk about angry fast from that 2-7 when he's up front. I can't imagine what this restart is going to be like. He'll know that the sweepers are out there cleaning up the high line. So Marty, I would expect the American's going to go big with just 70 laps to go.
Not a word from Alexander Rossi. He just dropped to the back of the field when Rob Edwards told him to do so. There you go. He'll
right
pull
there
in behind Max Chilton right there. But remember that conversation that I had with him, if he caught it, on NBCSports.com. He said, listen, this place brings out a different level in me. And yes, sometimes it does make me angry, and I want to take chances. So Rossi has had a miscommunication with a timing stand, missing pit road earlier. He made up that five-second deficit. Now he's at the back of the field, 71 laps to go. I think we're about to see some amazing highlights. What do you guys think?
He said to you, Marty, in your interview, we just got a no pit mistakes, and they've had pit mistakes today. So he's going to go big, go angry, but it's going to be interesting to see if guys let him go or they fight him back there, because you know, Townsend, the guys in the back fight you harder than the guys in the front.
Oh, you bet. And there's so much turbulent air back there, and Rossi's going to know that he has to make it happen right away, because he can't afford to let a few laps take place and let everybody kind of settle in and things start to train out. He's going to have to make quick work. But let's take a look at this stop. Everything was going just fine for the Napa boys until right here. Watch the right rear tire changer. Wheel comes off, gun goes down. He goes to pick up the gun and realizes that the nut has come out. He has to reach down and pick it up. He did a brilliant job to do that swiftly, but those were valuable seconds that allowed Sato and Award to catch up.
We're talking tenths of a second, because that guy on the back tire was super slick about getting it. He was done pretty much on time. But a few tenths of a second, and you lose two spots.
So here we go again. Alexander Rossi in the second half of the race having to play catch up. Let's rewind the clock to a year ago, and they had a refueling issue. This was a 23-second pit stop, and you could see there how furious he was. And then he went on the attack and pulled off some amazing moves. He found it difficult to get by Oriol Servia. Servia felt the wrath of Rossi as well. And then once he got over that, he just kept going and took the fight, led the race, arm wrestled Simon Pagenaud all the way to the end.
He's telling Chilt to go. Look, he's saying catch up to the pack. So, you know, he's had Townsend such a rough start to the start of the year, and it just continues. He's geared his whole season around trying to win this race, and it could unravel, and he's gonna, they're getting ready to go to green now.
By the way, just updating you that there were some late stoppers there. Elio Castro Neves, Spencer Pigot, they decided to top off. Let's go racing again. It's Felix Rosenquist at the front, Rinus VK, and then the 24 of Sage Karen. But then you pick up Scott Dixon, and Dixon is being hassled by a rookie in Pato O'Ward. Meanwhile, bottom of your screen, it's Alexander Rossi on the go.
And Karam and VK had a touch up there going into turn one as Ferrucci goes high once again. Too much, this is way too much fun. Rossi angry fast, Dixon trying to protect his car and get to the lead.
Rossi trying to get by Castro Neves right here. He gets a run off the corner.
slides up the inside, but it's all jammed up. Look at these guys just trying to get out of the way here. What's going on?
Oh, my gosh, Alexander Rossi. What a move.
Great job, great job.
That's at over 200 miles an hour, folks. Incredible.
Some type of issue going on with Pagano. He didn't get up to speed at all.
Rossi passed about five cars in that one move. That was a massive moment to the good for Alexander Rossi to get back to the front.
Dixon's gone to the front over teammate Felix Rosenquist. He is off strategy by about 30 plus laps as far as his last stop. Graham Rahal is ahead of teammate Takuma Sato. And then you've got Joseph Newgarden in the mix. Pato O'Ward's dropped back a couple of spots.
While all this has happened, Scott Dixon has gotten back to the lead in front of his teammates somehow. We had lap cars in the mix, and Dixon has worked his way from about fourth or fifth in line back to the lead.
Rossi has another good run here on Castroneves if he can hold onto the front straightaway.
Castroneves is not an easy guy to pass. He makes it hard for you. Not close enough, nowhere near close enough to make a move now.
Paul, we got to go back. Watch this. Just watch and listen here.
Radio's back. Still there.
From the bottom lane to the high lane and sweeping around.
Yeah.
And this is Pagano, who did not get up to speed.
Yeah, Pagano just was not. He was holding up the hole.
Oh,
that's why he didn't get up to speed. That was crazy.
Oh, my goodness. That's why he was ailing. So there's Dixon clearly out in front. Next closest is Rosenquist, but again, he's not on the same strategy. And then Graham Rahal. So an Andretti started on the pole. Can you imagine if a Rahal won?
Check this out. Dixon at the front. He's got lap cars. Pagano's got damage. Kevin, what's going on? Nose change?
Yes, definitely. You can see the damage as he comes in. So last year's winner in serious peril. He's going to fall a lap down. However, if it were to stay green the rest of the way, he now would be the only one that can definitely make it home on one more stop from here.
All right, check this out. Dixon up front. He's got a car, VK, that's fast in front of him that he can draft off of. Here's the replay with Hunter Ray moves over and bang, takes his nose off.
Oh, we just got popped inside.
And then he can't get any speed through the corner, but Dixon now has a car in front that he can draft off of and lapped cars in between him and his challengers, and he's pulling away. Look at that.
And also helping the lead for Dixon over Rahal and Sato is the fact that Sage Karam there in the 24 black and yellow car circulating pretty slow as Rosenquist goes to the inside to get around Karam.
Team strategy right now, if I was Chip, I'd say, hey, back these, slow down and back these guys up a bit. Now Dixon's alone. VK pulls in. If he checks these guys up, Marty, he can build a big gap.
And Dixon's got a massive chunk right now, 3 seconds over his teammate Felix Rosenquist, who will come to pit road shortly. He did ask what happened to Alexander Rossi. Mike Hull explained to him what went on, that Rossi had to go to the back. Meanwhile, Rossi immediately on the restart gained 6 spots. He's actually lost a spot since then. So I think the sledding, Townsend, in the back of the field is going to be a lot tougher for Alexander Rossi. Again, he had made his way up to 17th and lost a spot to Charlie Kimball since, trying to get that spot back now.
Rossi in 18th, working on Charlie Kimball, as you said. Getting great mileage back here, but he's going to need track position.
A little loose on entry there. Took a little wiggle on him.
One driver in this field that we have not spoken about much today, who started in 22nd position and has been cleverly and methodically working his way up and is on the same strategy as race leader Scott Dixon, is Will Power. He is now inside the top 10, just ahead of Tony Kanaan and behind Colton Herta. Power in that Verizon Chevrolet, don't discount him. The 2018 winner of this Indianapolis 500. But can anybody catch Dixon? Today, the answer kind of seems like no, because he's been in a class of his own, leading 91 laps as Rosenquist dives from pit lane.
Rahal now in second.
The team had told Felix Rosenquist to take the lead on that restart and keep it, but he was only able to hold on for a couple of laps before his teammate Scott Dixon got back around him. They kept him out as long as he could, but of course he needs to come get that speedway fuel. Didn't ask for any changes this time around, but Felix Rosenquist playing a dutiful teammate there for Scott Dixon.
As he is released, There's a 3.2-second margin between Scott Dixon and Graham Rahal in that United Rentals Honda. And then here's Rahal, Letterman, Lanigan teammate Takuma Sato. Then Joseph Newgarden, as high as he has been today, over Santino Ferrucci. That's your top five. Isn't that a beautiful sight? The colossal Indianapolis Motor Speedway from the air as we welcome you back to our coverage of the 104th running of the Indy 500 presented by Gainbridge on a beautiful but warm afternoon. And a reminder, Tuesday, September 1st, a doctor far from home with skills that will transform a team. Transplant. It premieres September 1st right here on NBC. So, for Chip Ganassi Racing, although one of the three cars crashed out at the hands of Marcus Ericsson, Scott Dixon leads and has led the most laps, almost 100, in fact, and he's upped his pace considerably. His teammate we saw dive for pit lane.
Yellow.
And there's another caution. And so Alexander Rossi. Rossi is out of this 500.
Well, this changes everything because Rossi has now crashed. We've got another yellow. And the split strategy, Townsend, we were talking about it during commercial.
You okay, Alex?
Ganassi's got this thing like totally timed right with both cars.
Might have helped Pagano tremendously make up ground already in the pits before the yellow came out. As Rossi climbs from the car, puts the steering wheel back. And
so right now, Rosenquist can do this on one more stop. Dixon potentially two. Dixon was running fast laps and just taken off from Sato. I think Sato's committed to trying to do it on one, but it's touch and go on that. So right now, the Ganassi, both of them look pretty good.
Alexander Rossi, as you saw there, his helmet's off. He's with the AMR safety team, and his 2020 Indy 500 comes to a halt. His fifth Indy 500.
It's up high. Well, got loose on him.
Whoa.
So just same thing as, exact same thing as what
Ericsson
happened to Ericsson.
Alexander had never finished worse than seventh in
this race.
Right
in front of me, too. See, I'm right there in that suite, and boom, he hits the wall right underneath of me there. Ends up pretty much down the other end of the straightaway.
Just got his hands off the wheel in time. He drove it as long and as far as he could until he was simply out of road. As you see his race engineer, Jeremy Millis, frustration once again.
Not really much Rossi could do. He was put into a box of having to go for it, right? He was up front all day, just sitting there waiting it out. And when you go to the back, because of the penalty, the pit road penalty, you've got to go on offense, and you're pushing hard, right?
Rossi had told me this morning just how loose you had to set up the car here at Indy this year to get it to work in traffic. And, I mean, he just loses the rear end, and that is a massive moment at those speeds. Tried to save it, but you'd simply just carry up the track, and you would need another 200 feet to the right to be able to drive that out.
Yeah, this season has just totally been a disaster for the most part, other than the one podium that he got at Road America. It's just he geared everything with the bad start around this race, trying to win this race, and it's all gone sideways
and
for him.
Up until that pit road penalty, Paul, it was going to plan.
It was.
He was at the front with Scott Dixon and dueling it out and working the strategy, and Alexander Rossi, who had been lower than 20th in the championship early on, clawed his way back to be inside the top 10 in the championship, and this one's going to hurt because, remember, the Indianapolis 500 is double championship points. So one of the favorites, Danica, is out.
I totally was calling Rossi to win this race. He was definitely my pick. But what I heard from Ed Carpenter the other day when I was talking to him was that the cars are even more difficult this year than any other year to get right. The window is even smaller. And from my experience, the window felt small a couple of years ago. And so I said, smaller than that? And he said, yeah, much smaller than that. So I think that's why you hear so many drivers saying, I don't know what happened. It just went on me.
Yeah, it's just a real weird turbulence that comes off the cars now with this windscreen. It's changed everything. It's changed the whole game, Townsend, of how you set the car up. And it, the game changes every year, but this was a big change this year with the safety innovation. But it hasn't affected Scott Dixon.
Not one bit.
You know, one of the things Fernando Alonso told me about the aero screen and what it prevents him from doing that he liked to do? When he'd come down the front straight, he liked to look at the pylon. And sometimes in a caution, you could look at the screen, at the big screens as well. And he said, now you've got that strip, you know, around the top. You can't see it. Not that you'd drive along looking in the sky, but he said, you look up and I like to look at the pylon, and now you can't do it.
Even at speed at 230 miles an hour, I know exactly what he's talking about. It's a good way to just sort of try to figure out where you sit and also some of the other cars that you might be curious about that you're racing against on strategy. See who comes to pit lane here.
Beautiful new Corvette Stingray, the pace car, the official pace car for the Indy 500 this year. And GM President Mark Royce led the field, paced the field, coming to green a little earlier today as we've got some takers with 53 laps to go.
Under yellow one more time under these blue skies and the light cirrus clouds here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, 104th Indianapolis 500, heading towards go time here. We have about 50 laps to go. Final quarter of the race. It is decision and pressure time. Alexander Rossi, the number two choice, according to the odds, in that accident just a moment ago. He's standing by now with Kevin Lee.
Alexander, the penalty for contact on pit lane puts you back. Then what happened with the contact?
We were never planning on being that far back. We just lost it. I mean, it's a lot of dirty air back there. It was tough in turn two all day, but up front where we should have been was the 27 lap auto parts automation Andretti Honda was awesome. So thought we had a car to win. I don't even want to talk about the penalty right now. I'm going to have a long conversation with someone about that.
So here it is. You're going to see it anyway. You disagree with that? Take us through your thinking coming out there.
Well, obviously I can't see anything. I just go on what I'm told, but still. Takuma's moving in reaction on restarts, doesn't get a penalty. It's just consistencies. We'll talk about it. I don't have an opinion right now. It's obviously frustrating. There's two sides to every story.
Thank you, Alexander.
Big frustration right now, Townsend, with the chief stewards. I know the feeling. I've been very frustrated, but bad day.
Bad day for sure. Bad season for Rossi as the cleanup continues.
Yeah, Townsend, the runner-up here last year and so close, as we mentioned, four times prior in the 500, always in the top seven, and had a car that would have been in that position again if not for the penalty, the aggressive nature to the restart, and involved in that incident. Let's take you back through what's happened if you are just joining us for the race recap. We get started with Scott Dixon passing Marco Andretti, who sat next to him on his front row, and Dixon has taken the lead and has been in the lead for the majority of this race. For Rinus VK, lap 62, this incident, contact with his member of his pit crew, who has turned out to be okay through this, had a stop and go penalty for that. On lap 92, scary moment as Connor Daly on the restart spins Oliver Askew, the rookie, and it's a dangerous crash as he hit hard as well. Both involved, both part of the half dozen now plus cars that are out of this Indy 500. Alex Palou is next in turn one. Same thing we've seen, people struggling to keep it in turn one, entering that short chute towards turn two. Palou hits the wall, and the rookie, who had been impressive, is out of the race. We just told you a moment ago about Rossi. Here was the penalty for the unsafe release as Takuma Sato was coming down that slow lane. There's too many cars coming out at the same time. Very quietly and dejectedly to the back of the pack, and then, as you heard him just tell Kevin, trying to make it all come back. Some impressive moves through the field on the restart. In the wall, lap 144, Rossi out of the race. And then Danica, here we are at lap 151, 49 to go, and it's really go time for these cars. And we look up at the pylon, and that nine of Scott Dixon is the number still up there on top.
It's just continuing to look better and better for Scott. Everything's filtering away, the strategies, the cars. I'm still stuck on Rossi's situation. I feel bad for him as a driver. You are just told to go. But, you know, we have a guy that looked like he had a really great shot at winning out of the race. So, again, attrition is such a huge part of the Indy 500, staying in it, staying clean, no mistakes by either you or your pit crew. We're down to crunch time, and oh, what do you know? The Iceman on the top.
Yep. Scott Dixon, he'll be in the lead when the green flies when we come back.
Chevrolet pace car, the Corvette Stingray, gives us a pretty nice view back to the field, back to a familiar position, the PNC Bank Honda of Scott Dixon, who, by the way, has written another little special piece of IndyCar history as he continues to rack up the numbers. He has just surpassed AJ Foyt and Mario Andretti for laps led, career laps led, at the Indianapolis 500, and is third on the all-time list. Very cool. At the age of 40. He turned 40 recently, but there is no stopping Scott Dixon.
Easy in range, too, to even take over the lead in that, Marty.
Paul, and also in his 20th season, it's amazing how good Scott Dixon is. And I talked to Chip Ganassi this morning about Scott. He said, I just see a whole new level of focus from the five-time champion this year. And Scott told me yesterday, listen, in the offseason, we had to have some very tough conversations with this race team as Simon Pagenaud comes down pit road, the 2019 winner of this race to top off here. He said, and in those tough conversations, we had to make some changes on this team. We brought in Michael Cannon as a new engineer, and it's made such a difference for them. And Lee, the season for Scott Dixon has been amazing. Started it with three straight wins, and here he is, 47 laps to go in the Indy 500, and he has been dominant. Can he win his second? We'll find out in a bit. A
couple of things here. That man there, Chip Ganassi, who raced in the Indy 500 himself, celebrating 30th anniversary season this year for Chip Ganassi Racing. He's also thinking a lot about Alex Zanardi, who raced for him, who won a couple of IndyCar titles for him. And Alex Zanardi, we got some promising news recently that Alex is taking some better steps forward in his recovery from that hand cycle accident. We are getting ready for the end of the sixth full course caution. Less than a quarter of the race to go. Dixon is out in front. Dixon is in control. Can anyone catch him?
We've got the Iceman and the Wild Thing, Townsend. And the Wild Thing's actually been pretty cool today. He's been riding and staying safe, so he's waiting for the end.
Well, Graham Rahal, his teammate, is not waiting for Sato. They go side by side and one.
Ferrucci. They almost touched.
Look at Newgarden. Newgarden to the outside. He's making his move right now.
On Graham Rahal, Newgarden, the two-time series champ, right around the outside in turn two.
Newgarden.
Great move, Joseph Newgarden.
Newgarden becomes a factor now for the win. He is desperate to win here, but in the back here, they are going wild. Marco, Hunter Ray, Castro Neves, power, slices to the outside.
Jack Harvey. Jack Harvey on board with Fernando Alonso. Around the outside of the one and two.
That's a wild one. He's still there.
Spencer Pickett on the inside in that high V Honda.
Now Alonso's out of the draft. Impressive. On a freshly swept track, Alonso working the high side. Here comes Hunter Ray. Marco appears to be struggling and falling back.
And that is the teenage rookie who is at the front of the field, Rinus Vicky, working on him. Vicky is back in 21st position in car 21.
Vicky a lap down right now, but now it all starts to string out. And Sato right there.
So Newgarden gets around Sage Karam, who's two laps down. Now Newgarden sets his sights on Takuma Sato and Scott Dixon. What a methodical advance for Newgarden so far in this race. We haven't talked a lot about him, but he knows with 43 laps to go, this is go time.
They kept saying, they being the Penske Chevrolet drivers, said, we know we weren't that good in qualifying. We can be there in the race. We believe that we'll have it on fuel range. We know that our team is good enough executing in the pits. Ferrucci clearing Sage Karam on the inside. No problem there. So it's now Scott Dixon, Takuma Sato, Joseph Newgarden, Graham Rahal, Santino Ferrucci in the top five.
Sato is right there, 0.2 seconds back. So he has closed the gap to Dixon. Newgarden 1.2 seconds back. If they work together here, making the fuel mileage, hopefully they can break away.
Pass for the lead there as Sato goes to the front. Dixon's last lap at 2:17. So I think Dixon happy once again to ride in second, make the mileage and try to give himself a little flexibility on the pit stop.
Big gap there just for passing in a couple corners. Dixon kind of fell back a little bit there, a little bit further than you'd want to.
Marty, what kind of conversation do you hear, if any, between Mike Hall on the stand and Scott Dixon?
That's exactly the conversation. Hey, we are right on the number to make it on one more stop. So if you can buy us a little bit, go ahead and let Sato go. So they let him go there. And talking to Takuma Sato earlier this week, he said, listen, that move I made trying to pass Dario Franchitti for the win in the Indy 500, I would make that move again. Remember, he wrecked that year, he said, but my risk versus reward now, much smarter at 43 than it was back then. So Sato out front leading his first lap of the day, but I think Dixon is kind of making a plan here, saving as much fuel as he can.
What a great run from Jack Harvey from 20th to 10th. in the Auto Nation Sirius XM car for Meyer Shank Racing. The British driver doing a super job. He's been just creeping his way forward all day long and staying out of trouble. He heads Helio Castro Neves, and he's behind Tony Kanaan.
Townsend, you coined the name the Wild Thing for Sato because he's so aggressive, but he has really played this race pretty cool.
Well, it can all go out the window in the last several laps, as every one of these drivers knows that with one more round of pit stops and no guarantee of any more yellow, you've got to start making your track position now if at all possible. But you can see already since that restart how things have stretched out as Sage Karam passed by James Hinchcliffe.
Hinchcliffe running in eighth, having a nice run. Kanaan is ninth, Harvey 10th. Castro Neves has moved his way all the way from the back now up to 11th. Working on Jack Harvey, got a nice run there off the corner. He might have an opportunity. A little bit far back at the start-finish line.
For those of you just turning on, wherever you're watching around the world, welcome to our coverage here on NBC. It's been a pretty high attrition rate. Crashes suffered by Alexander Rossi, Alex Palou,
I think
Oliver Askew, Connor Daly, Dalton Kellett all crashed out. So too with Marcus Ericsson. And then James Davison had a front right wheel and brake problem. Riding on board the United Rentals Honda with Graham Rahal.
I think Dixon is leaving a big enough gap behind Sato Townsend that Sato would really have to back off to let him go by. So he's trying to force Sato to lead.
So where do we have to get to, like 66, 67?
Graham, you drove a hell of a race, and we'd like to keep doing what we're doing.
Oh, Graham Rahal getting wide there in two. Had to check up. Now he looks in his mirrors to see if anybody has a run behind him.
He almost took my tie with him.
Santino Ferrucci is the next one in the line behind Graham Rahal. And he's not that far. He's only a few tenths of a second behind Rahal. It's close.
And Lee, Graham Rahal has driven a spectacular race, sitting in fourth. And I love what he told me earlier this week and the fact that he said, if I'm going to win this race, and I desperately want to win this race to take the pressure off me, I have to find a new level of aggressiveness. That's going to be early in the race. It's going to be late in the race. And Graham has been very smart, calculated, if you will, running up front. The Rahal-Letterman Lanigan team is second and fourth, or first and fourth right now, with David Letterman in the house checking out the show. Graham putting on a show.
Townsend, these guys all know that they got to make a little bit of mileage to get to the end, so that I feel they're just leaving enough gap to, you know, basically force the guy to stay in front of you.
Well, we're going to get really close here to the go-home lap number. Final pit stop coming up, 163. I think go-home's probably around 166, as you heard Graham Rahal speculate. So all of the strategists will be studying the data and trying to figure out how to either play it safe if you're somebody like Dixon, who's been so strong today, or if you're going to gamble.
Pace right now at the front, 217.2 for Sato. Kelly Dixon, 217.5 in his toe.
Well, Tim Cindric, strategist and team president there on the one car, said during that last caution, if you want to win this race, we are going to have to save a lot of fuel during this stint. He was obviously aggressive on the restart, got around Graham Rahal, and now they said, save fuel, but don't lose track position. Remember, Joseph told me that you've got to be in the top three by that final pit stop to have a shot at this race. And now the challenge is not to lose a track position, but to also save fuel.
Paul,
sounds easy, right?
Paul, you know what that's like. That's like telling you to go to Vegas and say, have a great time, but don't spend too much.
Yeah, but the gap right there is too big. He needs to close that gap maybe by about a third, because that gap between him and Rahal is about perfect for saving a lot of fuel. When you open that gap, the wind hits your car and you don't save as much fuel.
Who's going to be the first to come? If there's no more caution, who is going to be the first to pit last? 35 laps to go on a day that has seen six full course cautions.
Whoa. Graham Rahal pushing up high again as he comes by me here and pushes up again. Got a little bit of understeer in that car. He likes to run close to the wall. Townsend, you and I don't like to see it, but he kind of shrugs his shoulders to it.
Certainly has plenty of experience up there in the light gray as Newgarden holding pace lap 166. So I think at this point now, Marty, everybody should be safe to be able to make it on the last stop.
Yeah, two or three more laps here.
That's exactly right. Chase Cindric, Kjell Joseph Newgarden, three more laps. I told Takuma Sato, two more laps until he comes to pit road. Dixon going to try and stretch it to 168 if he can. That would buy him a little bit, and that's why he let Sato by earlier, just trying to buy some extra laps, give him some reassurance on the back end.
It's been a massive week for Graham Rahal right there. His wife, Courtney, is not here because they're expecting their first child, so not safe to travel at the moment. They had their Graham and Courtney Rahal Foundation golf outing earlier this week, again raising hundreds of thousands of dollars. Sam Schmidt from Arrow McLaren SP also ran the virtual Conquer Paralysis Now Gala. They raised more than $500,000, so people in this field focused on motor racing also doing some wonderful philanthropic work. Well done.
Sato Dixon last lap, 217.8, pulling away from Newgarden a little bit as Marco comes down for his last stop.
Here comes Marco Andretti coming down pit road, and Brian Herta has made this call a number of times today, coming a little bit earlier than everybody else, pitting though with 33 to go, so he should be good to make it to the end. Speedway Fuel to make it to the end. Takuma Sato coming down pit road. We'll see if these fresh Firestones getting on a little bit earlier than everybody else helps him. You see the wing change a little bit there too for Marco as he leaves pit road. Meanwhile, Takuma Sato said he had been struggling with 3 and 4 when they were in traffic, but when he was out front in clean air, much better. Sato coming down pit road. Newgarden in front of you, Kelly.
And Joseph Newgarden asking for no changes on that pit stop. His pit crew has been phenomenal. We'll see how this one plays out.
This is the critical pit stop. You got to have a clean one. Marco's stop was pretty slow. Newgarden's was fast. Look, he almost got around Sato, but Dixon's team has been flawless on pit lane so far. No mistakes on this one, because this is potentially the last one, and here he comes.
Scott Dixon to pit lane, the most important stop of the season for the 9 team right here.
And they have been phenomenal, Marty, all day.
That's the point I was going to make, Lee. 31 to go. They've been outstanding all day long. Let's see if Scott Dixon's team can deliver on the most pressure-packed stop of the entire year. The car has been flawless. They've asked Scott several times today, do you want any changes? Every time he has said no. Meanwhile, Joseph Newgarden on the track around Takuma Sato a little bit longer on that stop for Dixon and his team. We'll see how that affects the track position and where he cycles out.
There was an issue on the back inside corner on Dixon's car. He was a little slow on that one, so we'll see where they're going to cycle here.
Watch the blend. There's Sato. There's Newgarden coming through turn two. Scott Dixon trying to get up to speed.
Look at this. There they are.
I think Sato, he's got
Newgarden
enough.
And Rahal. Rahal in the mix right there.
Whoa.
Trying to block Newgarden.
Back.
Looks like Dixon is safe. That was a little bit of a slow stop, but he had a good in lap. He's getting up to speed now, but this gap will close down. But it stayed status quo. But that was touch and go, guys.
So it's all day Scott Dixon has given up the lead to try to save fuel. But right now, no fuel savings necessary. This is a chance to see how fast Scott Dixon can go to the finish.
Closing 26 laps of the 104th running of the Indianapolis 500, presented by Gainbridge, and Takuma Sato in the People Ready Honda leading Scott Dixon, leading his teammate. Now, when I say leading, technically they're not, because Zach Veach is in the lead of the race. But Veach and Max Chilton are on different strategies to Takuma Sato. And this is how Takuma put the move for what is ostensibly the lead on Scott Dixon.
Had a great run coming out of turn four. Takuma Sato knew that on new tires, his best chance potentially to get Dixon was early in this stint. It'll be fascinating, Paul, to see if Dixon can respond. Now, it looks like he's struggling to stay close, and here comes Rahal and Santino Ferrucci.
For sure, both Rahal, Letterman, Lanigan cars are super fast at the end of the race. But I think, you know, right now, Dixon is nose. You don't want to lead coming to the last couple laps. So I think he's prepared to sit here and watch Sato's car and see where it's weak.
We're going to squeeze in one last break and then take you all the way to the checkered flag for the final 20 laps. 20 to go. That is it. No more commercials. We'll take you all the way to the checkered flag here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Takuma Sato, Scott Dixon. This is for the win of this race. And you can see in the background there, Graham Rahal has dropped off a little bit. There was some trouble getting by Ben Hanley in the Dragon Speed car. Santino Ferrucci in the bright yellow Sealmaster entry now clears the British driver.
Rahal's got a little bit of understeer, Townsend, in his car, on his in car. I can hear he's not flat out. So they pulled the gap now, and the battle now is between the two front cars, and Dixon is closing that gap down.
But boy, it's tough to follow another car, Marty, because Sato made his move early. I wonder if Dixon's going to have enough. So much harder late in the stint to get close.
It is a challenge, and let's be clear, Zach Veach still leading this race with 19 to go, but they do have to come back to pit road. So effectively, this is the battle for the win. Takuma Sato, Scott Dixon. They told Dixon, hey, let Sato go. Buy us a couple laps of fuel. The magic mark for Scott Dixon to get back on full rich and go as hard as he could was 20 to go. We're at 19 to go. He's closing in that gap on Takuma Sato, but maybe not as quick as Dixon would like. Townsend, to your point, it's tough to follow another car, even tougher to pass him. Dixon's had the car all day long. Can he get it done in these final 18 laps?
The last lap was a 2:19 for Dixon and 2:18 for Sato, so he is closing that gap, but I still feel, Townsend, that he's prepared to just sit and wait this out a little bit, like a chess match.
18 laps.
18 laps to go. Sato, Dixon, a couple of Honda-powered cars making another one in Graham Rahal, making another one in Santino Ferrucci. First Chevrolet-powered car is Joseph Newgarden, who will be in fifth. This is the Gainbridge-sponsored Andretti Autosport Honda of Zach Veach. He leads the race for now, but needs to come in. He last pitted on lap 147.
If it sounds like Zach Veach will come to pit road around lap 90 for just a quick fuel-only stop. I know it was strategy that got him to the front, but he told me he had a small checklist for this race, and to lead laps at the Indianapolis 500 was on that list, so he gets to tick that box today.
Think about this, about Takuma Sato, and as far as how bizarre and disappointing and just so totally different 2020 has been for all of us all around the world. Of course, we know about the postponements of the Tokyo Summer Games. Takuma was meant to be one who was to run with the Olympic flame. That, of course, didn't happen. So in replacement of that, if he wins his second Indianapolis 500, that'll be quite the buzz. And of course, we will be back in Tokyo 2021 those Summer Games.
Not only that, guys, you know, he stayed here through COVID. He didn't have an opportunity to go home and see his family. He's been here for so long, living at his manager's house. So it's been a total, no opportunity to see any of his family in Japan.
Good to go here. We're good. Let's go.
That's Mike Hall saying we're good to go. We're good on fuel, so let's go. Question is, can the 9 of Scott Dixon find the handling to get close? It sure looks like it as Dixon comes off 4 with authority.
It certainly does this lap here as he steps on the gas and finds another gear. Sato squeezes him to the outside that lap.
Sato's
19.5.
Sato's got to be careful. That was definitely in reaction to Dixon's move. Think about
Townsend, there's been a lot of talk about would they call blocking today. Several people have filed a complaint with the stewards to say, hey, Takuma Sato has been blocking on restarts and during runs. You got to wonder if they do that again. If Sato does that again, would the stewards call it?
Rahal's coming too. Last lap was a 2:20. Rahal's closing that gap down. As we look at the replay here, he protects the inside. Dixon goes for the outside, and he didn't shut the door that hard, Townsend. There was still room there, and it's going to get a lot more aggressive than that.
Here we go again. Dixon thought about it outside into turn one. Think about how the track is evolving as well as those shadows grow longer and larger. Late into the afternoon here, almost 5:30 local time in Indianapolis.
The definition of a blocking penalty is moving in reaction to. And when I just watched Sato, I did not see that. I saw Sato move before Dixon popped out. So I think Sato is dancing on a fine line there, Danica. What do you think?
One of the things as a driver you're thinking about here, especially coming into the final laps of the race, is that what if there's a green-white checkered? What if there's a last, very end of the race yellow flag?
Scott doesn't want to use his tires up trying to get by him. He still has time, but when Sato does things like he did and makes it difficult on him, all of a sudden he's using up his tires and he's making him frustrated. So you're also very much as a driver thinking about the very end of the race and what happens if you need as much rubber as possible.
Yeah, the preferred pass is down the inside, and right now Sato is doing the exact same thing that Simon Pagenaud did last year to win the race, and he's protecting the inside and going to make Dixon go to the outside.
13 laps to go. It'll be 12 this time across the yard of bricks, and Sato hugs that inside lane. He's watched plenty of what Pagenaud did last year, and he almost was there to win his second a year ago. Think about that. That year that he tried to make that inside move on Dario Franchitti. This man here, the veteran of 90 Formula One Grand Prix, could maybe be a 3 or 4-time Indy 500 winner.
Clear by five.
Hey, and Lee, remember when Takuma Sato won the 2017 Indy 500? How did he do it? With a pass on the outside. It's clear he's going to make Scott Dixon do that if he wants to win the 2020 Indy 500.
This is going to be interesting as Takuma Sato comes off turn four. There's traffic further up the road.
That's going to affect the balance of Sato's car, and he's going to need to make changes inside the cockpit, Townsend. Once you start getting turbulence, you're going to have to adjust on your tools. It might open up the opportunity for Dixon, but right now Sato's pulled the gap again.
That's Charlie Dixon. Kimball up the road, about 4 seconds up, lapping at 214 miles an hour. So I think lap traffic is going to figure in the closing laps.
Last lap for Sato was a 219.7, Dixon a 219.4. So he's responding to the Dixon pressure.
Sato's children, his son and his daughter, are watching from Tokyo in Japan. They may not have seen Dad with the Olympic torch, but they may see him win a second Indy 500. For Scott Dixon, his new baby boy is here. He's had two daughters for a long time, and along came baby Kit. And for Graham Rahal, he's awaiting the birth of his first child.
Dixon cannot leave this big gap. If Sato gets to Townsend, those three cars, and is able to time it right, he'll have a buffer. That's too big of a gap to leave.
And none of those three cars need to pit. That's Chilton, Kanaan, Kimball, all battling on the lead lap for position in this race. So there will be no help for Sato. It's coming in about a lap.
Still clear by eight, no pressure.
220 the last lap, 0.4 this lap. 221.5 for Sato to a 220.3 for Dixon. So he's pulling away.
He's gapped him by about a second now.
Well, but he's picked up the draft from the traffic. It's about to get a lot more difficult for Takuma Sato. He's got a lot of laps on the tires. He's had clean air, but you can throw that out the window. He's going to have to fight for this win.
Tony Kanaan, Ed Carpenter, and Charlie Kimball are the three up ahead. There they are.
He's got a wicked fast car. He's just got to time this right. And if he times it and he's got a buffer of cars, it could be game over.
Right, let's go.
Coming to eight to go.
These double points here at the Indianapolis 500 are going to help him tremendously in the bigger picture view of the championship, because he comes in well outside the top 10. It'll vault him well inside the top 10.
It's a big gap, Townsend.
Dixon's really sliding around, just hanging on, trying to figure out how to advance. Now watch Sato's lap time here. He's going to be way slower this lap.
Last laps for this group is 2:14, so they're running about 6 miles an hour slower than the leader. And now he's checked it, got checked up, Lee.
Last lap for Sato, 2:18.8, as they come across the yard of bricks.
7 to go, and he's got to make a move. He's got to try and clear this traffic.
Not happening. Sato just did a 2:17. Here comes Dixon. Here comes Graham Rahal.
2:17 for Dixon, so he didn't close any, but now he's stuck here. The handling is going to change. Can he make the pass? Does he have a car balanced enough in the draft? It's one 14, thing to seven. Lead and have clear road. Big dust from the oil dry, but nowhere to go, Townsend.
And look in the background. Not only is Dixon looking forward at Sato, Rahal has suddenly arrived on the back of that PNC Bank Honda. There's Graham.
And Santino Ferrucci. Guys, we're going to have a 4 or 5 car battle for the win.
These guys do not want to finish a lap down. They are fighting. Kimball passes his teammate into turn one. Still nowhere for Sato to go.
So Carpenter has cleared out.
Oh, the gap just closed big.
Sato has to make this move. He's got to get by Tony Kanaan, otherwise he's going to have company. Here he goes.
Inside.
Oh, huge break for Sato to get a car between himself and Scott Dixon. Now, Rahal and Ferrucci all over the back of Scott Dixon.
Tony Kanaan has tremendous respect for his ex-teammate. I will suspect that he will let him go by on the front straightaway here.
Dixon looking to clear Kanaan. Does it happen fast enough for Scott's liking? Not just yet. Dixon to the inside. Rahal will follow as well. Ferrucci not close enough to get through on that same opening.
Now look at the gap. Look at the gap Dixon needs to make up. That little break that Sato got was a huge amount of breathing room.
It's a 1 second gap now between the two, but the laps are not quick. 2:10 on that last lap for Dixon, 2:13 for Sato, and he's built a big gap.
But Charlie Kimball is still in front of Sato, circulating much slower.
Oh, big crash.
Boy.
Into the attenuator. No.
That's right at Pitty, and that's Spencer Piggott.
This is going to cause a red flag for sure, because they're going to want to finish this under green.
Right at the pit attenuator, right on the very end.
Oh, that's a big crash.
Oh, boy.
Drama. Huge drama.
Spencer's now raising the visor. That signifies that he's alert and awake, and it's a sign to race control and the AMR safety team.
Coming off turn four, these speeds at the end of the race, these Rahal cars have been running 220-mile-an-hour laps, and look at the end of the pit wall. It looks as though he lost it coming off the corner. You see the skid marks, and he hit the tire attenuator. And
oh, boy, that is a huge impact. What a relief to see Spencer moving inside the cockpit. I mean,
well, it's four laps now. If they don't red flag, then it's over. Sato will win this, but
wow.
I would be very surprised if they don't red flag it and have a shootout, a three-lapper.
26-year-old Floridian, gingerly out of his Hy-Vee Honda. Oh, boy. While his two teammates from Rahal, Letterman Lanigan, this is the Citroen Buell Autosport side of the team, are vying for the win. This talented youngster ends his race in spectacular style and certainly not the way he wants.
Already way loose, loses it, brushes the wall, not super hard, and then it just hooks itself and that's the worst case scenario right there.
He's going over 100 miles an hour and comes to effectively a full stop. Listen here.
Oh. And that is why we have this new safer screen, because I really believe, Townsend, that just saved his life. Those tires, if those tires would have come over the top of the car and hit him in the head,
yeah,
who knows what would have happened.
So he gets to see the target, and then he knows that he's in for a wallop of a hit. I've been in that situation before, Paul, and you have too. You simply, I mean, all the wind's knocked out of you.
Yeah, a guy, perfect case, a guy that knows that well as an ex-IndyCar driver, Mark Dismore, hit the end of the pit wall and it split the car in half and went down the pit lane, and that was just wild. But this new safer windscreen, the aero screen, has just done unbelievable things for the safety of these drivers. And look at this.
And look, earlier, Oliver Askew, who crashed just a little further back up the track, he paid testament to Dallara, the manufacturer of these Indy cars, along with the new aero screen and work with Red Bull Technologies. It speaks to the robust nature and the safety cell that the drivers sit in, because that car hit dead center and ricocheted ferociously off the other side as the AMR safety team just attend to Spencer Piggott, who got from the car. You see Spencer moving his hands and arms. They're speaking with the AMR safety team, but whew, that was a monstrous impact. So while they look after Spencer, we will step away just for a moment. We'll be back to finish off this Indianapolis 500. As you rejoin us, I can tell you that this race will not be red flagged, and it will finish under yellow with Takuma Sato winning his second Indianapolis 500 for Rahal Lederman-Lanigan Racing. His other win was for Michael Andretti. This one for Bobby Rahal, Mike Lanigan, and David Lederman. And there is the 1986 winner, Bobby Rahal on the right. Delighted. It wasn't his son, but it was one of his drivers. And Taku has done it for the second time in 3 years.
Townsend, it's the wild thing no more. He was super cool Sato today. We got to come up with a new nickname because he played his cards perfect today.
He's a recovered wild man. Sato, so measured, especially when he caught the traffic. He waited for his moment with Tony Kanaan. And Marty, we're looking at a two-time winner coming for the last lap and a half here.
Yeah, and just imagine being Scott Dixon after leading 111 laps today. This will be his third second-place finish in the Indianapolis 500. All three of them came under caution. He told me earlier this week, those are the worst. You can see it, you can touch it, you can taste the wind, and you can't go race for it. I cannot stand it when it finishes under caution, but that's the rule. So Scott Dixon looks like he will finish second in the Indianapolis 500 after leading 111 laps for the third time under caution.
Dixon, the dominant car today, but Sato was there with him all day. He was never worse than top five and was there all the time, but just waited for the right moment and got ahead of Dixon and never looked back.
I'll go back to that restart where Sato decided to go after it early, and I don't think that it was a foregone conclusion that Dixon would be able to get back by. He seemed to really struggle.
Everything's good. Just keep doing what you're doing.
They still have to coach him home for one lap for Sato, but I think the decision to go early and make his move was the winning decision. I'm not sure Dixon could have gotten back by.
The speeds were too high. They had ramped it up to 220s and 21s. And
there's David Lederman.
There's the boss.
He's thrilled. That's the team's first win since our mate Buddy Rice won all the way back in 2004. Here is the move. And it wasn't for the lead of the race, ultimately. It was for the win.
And
it wasn't just that move, Paul. It was the block. Well, I shouldn't say block. It was the defensive driving that Sato displayed, the lessons he learned by watching Pagano do the same thing last year. And he did that for a few laps, and that took the advantage off Dixon's tires to respond.
There was nothing, though, that was out of line. He just was driving the line that he needed to when Dixon was pursuing and had a chance to challenge. But ultimately, when it came down into the final 10 laps, Sato had a faster car and started to pull away.
This 43-year-old, now two-time winner from Japan, there will be thousands, and I mean thousands of kids cheering for him in Japan. The reason why 6 years ago, Taku started a thing with You Japan, the Kids Kart Challenge, and he just wanted kids to help them achieve their dreams. And he did so much in the tsunami relief as well. This guy has done so much. He was the toast of Japan when he was a Formula One driver. He's been now in IndyCar longer than he was in Formula One.
Thing to the checkered flag, buddy.
And this is a really special moment. Really special moment, and the way that he had to fight.
Yeah, let's bring this thing home, man.
Let's bring it home, and he is.
Thanks, guys, Eddie. We won it.
Takuma Sato is a two-time winner of the Indianapolis 500. For Rahal Lederman-Lanigan Racing, Sato, Dixon, and Rahal.
You are the man. You drove the wheels off that thing today. Awesome job.
No shortage of drama, even though we didn't have fans. What a race today.
Great job. Spotters, everybody. Great day. Woo! Yeah!
Kevin?
Well, Bob Rahal won this race in 1986 as a driver. Now you've won it twice as a car owner. How did Takuma hold off Scott Dixon?
Well, I mean, Takuma ran hard all day long, you know, and, you know, in the end, I was really worried that once we ran up against that traffic, that, you know, they'd kind of foul things up. And Takuma got through it pretty good. Dixon and Graham got through it pretty good, but... I think Takuma got through it just enough, just enough of a gap that was all it took. And then, of course, the accident who knows what would have happened those last five laps. But I know Graham was giving it everything he had and had a really good race. And, of course, for Takuma, you know, two-time winner in the Indy 500, that's pretty cool.
And first and third, your son finishes third.
Well, you know, we worked hard since last year's Indy 500. Really proud of the team. We qualified well as a group, and of course the race pace was quite good. And you know, it's just tough to pass. And you know, when Graham got up to Dixon, it was close, but just not quite enough. And Dixon couldn't quite get it to Takuma. So there it was. But a great. Obviously, we feel very, very happy.
Congratulations, Bobby Rahal, Mike Lanigan, David Letterman, winners, and Takuma Sato is now a two-time winner of the Indianapolis 500.
Oh, the screams of joy and the celebrations in the Takuma Sato camp at Rahal, Letterman, Lanigan Racing. In that People Ready Honda. It's just starting to sink in. And he is now a two-time Indianapolis 500 winner. Steve Fusick there, his manager, Bobby Rahal in, all helping the diminutive Japanese driver out of the car. Oh, boy. First front row start at the 500, and he converts it to a victory. This checkered flag moment is brought to you by Advance Auto Parts. And he's the first, as far as the 500 is concerned, to go up that lift. It has happened, of course, when we were here for the doubleheader weekend, IndyCar and NASCAR for the very first time at the Brickyard earlier this year in July. That's quite the ride. Just one of many improvements from the captain, Roger Penske, since acquiring the Speedway earlier this year. Some $15 million worth of improvements, and it is noticeable. And Roger is right down there on the spot. He's looking up, he's watching.
Lee wheeling Takuma Sato into victory lane. I love that Bob Rahal wanted to ride up on the lift. Enjoy the moment, right? Taku now a two-time Indy 500 winner, and you can see him in the car just kind of looking to the sky, savoring the moment, almost praying, if you will. You don't get to do this very often in your career, and Taku certainly taking this one in. You know, it's 6:45 a.m. Monday morning in Japan, but I have a feeling there's a party going on in Tokyo as Takuma kind of enjoys this moment. Takuma, you can climb out if you want. Takuma Sato, the 2020 winner of the Indianapolis 500. Oh, the one-legged stand. The winner's wreath from BorgWarner. We'll bring in the milk as well from the Indiana dairy farmers. 2% for Takuma was the choice today. Gonna hop off, and here comes the milk, everyone. And then from Jostens, the winner's ring as well. Such tradition here in Indianapolis. And a hug. Takuma showing off all the wares from Indianapolis. And a big smile on his face. Let's go over and grab a word with him. He wants to go celebrate with the crew. Ricardo Nault with a hug. And a hug for the crew members who were blessed enough to be up here. David Letterman right behind you as well. You might as well go hug the other boss.
Got it. God bless you, my friend. Thank you very much. Thank you. Hell of a job. Hell of a job. Oh, my God.
I love you, buddy. Well done.
Thank you. Thank you. This is unbelievable.
And then finally, Bob Rahal.
Congrats, babe. Congrats.
We'll certainly let that one happen. Hey, Taku, how big's the party in Japan right now?
This is unbelievable. Thank you so much. I can't find a word. Can't find a word.
How did you hold Scott Dixon back, Taku, who had the best car all day long?
Yes.
We did. I think we did. And obviously we lapped short from Dixie. And we knew in terms of the fuel strategy was a little tight. I couldn't use the max power, so I had to switch back and forth. And Scott was coming right through out of turn four. He's screaming coming, and
yeah.
I was just held off. So thank you so much.
At 43, you told me Friday, I'm not slowing down. I'm better than I've ever been. What kind of statement is it to come out and win the Indy 500 and pass the guy who led the most laps today?
This is unbelievable. Entire Ray Hall, Letterman Lanning and team, Panasonic, people already, Honda, did a hell of a job. HPD, Honda, oh, give us a lot of power, a lot of fuel mileage. And the 30 boys, and Eddie, you know, my engineer.
Yeah.
Family and sacrifice a lot, but you know, here Stephen Sue, it's my American family, should be happy with that. And Bobby, you know, Mike Lanigan, David Letterman, oh, I can't thank enough to all the people.
You're holding the Japanese flag in 2017. You said it was all for your country. How much of this is for your people in Japan?
Well, it's great, obviously, worldwide, and this is a mega sport. I'm really proud of part of winners again, but especially for Japan. Sacrifice a lot of, you know, after earthquake in 2011, and still today is a lot of raining and earthquakes. So I hope this gives a little boost for the energy, and thank you for a lot of support.
There you go. Takuma Sato in victory lane for the second time at Indianapolis, Kelly.
Well, Scott Dixon led 111 laps, and Scott, unfortunately for you, they just weren't the last laps. What did you have planned for Takuma Sato if it had run out green?
Yeah, it's definitely a hard one to swallow for sure. You know, I think we had such a great day. I don't know, with fuel mileage there, I really can't see how they were going to make it. You know, we pitted a lap later, and the numbers we had to get, you know, was going to be extremely difficult. And I think they even hesitated one of the times on straight when I pulled beside them. I think they were trying to figure out whether they just save fuel and try and get to the end. And then they just decided to go and run it. First time I've seen them let it run out like that. I thought they were definitely going to throw a, you know, a red flag, which would have been interesting, I think, for the last four or five laps. But huge congrats to Sato, drove his pants off today, you know, and to Ray Hall, Letterman, Lanigan. You know, they were super fast, obviously, a 1-3. Big day for Honda, so massive thank you. Proud to be powered by, you know, HPD and Honda, and, you know, it's nice to gather some points, but it's hard when it slips away like that. You know, I think we're definitely in the right seat. I think we had the mindset and maybe the fuel to get to the end, but you hesitate, and that's what happens.
Tough one to swallow for Scott Dixon, but a solid day today nonetheless.
We are wrapping things up here at the Brickyard at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, but it's been a huge weekend of motorsport. The NASCAR Cup Series second race, because it's been a double header. That's currently airing over on NBCSN. Been a double header for Xfinity and also for Cup this weekend. So don't forget, there's more racing still going on. This is the Children's Miracle Network moment of the race. And it's the moment where 43-year-old Japanese driver Takuma Sato became a two-time Indianapolis 500 winner. Pretty amazing stuff. Mike Lanigan is there, David Letterman is there, and of course Bobby Rahal is there. The three gentlemen, there's Mike Lanigan leading on the BorgWarner. I'm not sure you're supposed to do that, Mike, but anyway, he's the boss and he's the winning team owner, one of them anyway. And this is a magical moment for Takuma Sato, one of the veterans of IndyCar and global motorsport. It has been a busy period the last couple of weeks with the big practice days, qualifying weekend, carb day, and then today, the day we love the most. On behalf of the whole team, thank you so much. Great job, guys. And to wrap it up, we're going to send it back to Danica and Mike.
All right, Diff, great job, as always. Spencer Pigot, by the way, involved in that hard crash there that ended, essentially ended the race. He has been examined at the Infield Care Center, is awake and alert, but will be transported down 16th Street to Methodist Hospital for further evaluation. Danica, you won your IndyCar race in Japan. You know what this sport means to those folks. What does this Sato win mean back home in the land of the rising sun?
Well, Japanese fans get coined super fans because they are that passionate about their athletes and about sports. I have no doubt that when he arrives back in Japan, whenever he does, they should have a camera at the airport for everyone there that's probably going to be greeting him. But wow, what a day for Bobby Rahal and his team. Graham finished third. What an incredible day.
Great run for Santino Ferrucci. Honda 1-4 there. as you look at the rest of the top 10. Speaking of top 10, I see David Letterman, I think top 10 list. You heard that laugh in the 12. The home office at the Brickyard from David Letterman, a Hoosier at heart. Marco Andretti, who was on the pole, finishes 13th in his quest to be the second time getting Andretti into victory circle here and on down 18, finishing on the lead lap. Paul Tracy was talking about he thought there was going to be a red flag. Do you agree with the decision that happened? No red flag, let it finish under caution.
I do. I think that it was a stretch to call a red flag. I think that it was there was probably grounds for it, but I think it would have been pushing it, and it would have it was fair to do it the way it was done. It was going to be a really long yellow at that.
We started the day talking about the fans. We do miss the fans, but you know the folks of Indianapolis and the Indy fans around the country will be back here in May, health permitting, to make the 500 even better next year.
I have a feeling that the 2021 Indy 500 is going to be perhaps the biggest one yet.
Just that feeling.
Calling that? I'm calling that.
Right there with you. Great, great doing this again. We'll ride shotgun again soon.
Thanks, Mike. This is fun.
With Danica Patrick, Mike Tirico, the rest of our NBC team, thanks for joining us as Takuma Sato becomes the 20th multiple winner of the Indianapolis 500. Remember, the racing's on NBCSN. Next, for many of you, the news, except on the West Coast. The sports continues tonight in primetime, 8 Eastern, up to the bubble in Toronto. It's game one with the second round of the Stanley Cup playoffs. The Bruins and the Lightning, going to be an exceptional series, and a doubleheader of IndyCar just outside of St. Louis for you next week at 3 Eastern time. For our entire team, Mike Tirico, so long from the Brickyard, where Takuma Sato has won the 104th running for the Indianapolis 500.